Hey everybody, this is Jeff Lafferty and ArtCast 227. We've got Scott Circland, Jay Ferguson, Brody Williams, and myself, of course. How's everybody doing?
Doing good.
Doing real good. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty good.
Yeah.
Guys must be tired. Some responses.
Yeah, I'm
that's just one of those days.
I did get my coffee back, so.
Well, that's good at least.
Yeah. I was up late night trying to figure out how to do 3D for these prints, and I think I got it figured out. But it's a lot of like trial and error as far as the right colors and the right registration and everything. But.
Oh really?
Yeah.
You got some like glasses to kind of test it out.
So what?
You got some.
Yeah. I got here. So these are my old comic book pages I was telling you about that I did as a kid, the 3D ones. I did one that was better that I used stencils and it worked a little better, but then I tried to do these. They actually worked a little bit. Now this one and then this one here.
Cool.
But then I found some old found some old 3D comics. So I've just been looking at these and this one. They're actually cool. And this one, this has got a Bernie Wrightson cover on it. Seduction.
Oh, wow.
Yesterday when you were talking about those 3D comics. Didn't they used to use, like, I know they used, like, the red and the blues, but didn't they use, like, dot systems? Like, I guess, like, an overlay pattern of, like, small dots and stuff?
Not necessarily for these, because these are all, like, solid line. You know, it's all one solid color, like a regular black and white with no tones to it. Mm-hmm. The one I'm working on, I'm going to do grayscale, and then, so it'll have some tones to it. But yeah, that's just the printing, the printing process. When you back then, they only, you know, you're dealing with your CMYK colors, and so you take those four colors and you make other colors with those. And basically, mm-hmm. the process is like so. Some of them, if there's, you know, a little bit of blue, you might have just the blue dot pattern, and then maybe some yellow underneath it, and that'll make green or whatever. So it just kind of depends.
Yeah, because I wasn't sure. I noticed that Manga Studio has a lot of those tones, the tone patterns that you can.
I use a lot of those just for a cool effect nowadays, but there's still, I mean, anything that's like offset printed or whatever. I don't know if digital does that too, but I don't think so. But if you look, like if you take like a little. What do they call it? A loop, like a little magnifying glass, and you look at them, you know, in a magazine. They'll all have those dot patterns in it. Some of them are just tighter than others.
So how you doing, Brody?
Doing good, man.
That's cool.
Good.
How about you, Jay?
Yeah, I'm doing good. Yeah.
That's good.
Working on their Black Cat?
Yeah.
That's pretty neat.
Yeah, I kind of had like a marathon night last night. I got three pieces done. Well, this will be three when it's done.
So. Wow.
Holy smoke.
Yeah. Like at every show, you got like a almost like fully painted piece that he's working on. Something different every show. It's insane.
Well, you got to pay the bills.
I was like, man, I was like, do you ever sleep?
Not really.
That's awesome, though, man.
Not bad. Don't sleep.
So Jeff, on that piece that you're working on, all that white area, is that gesso stuff you were telling me about?
Yeah. looking for a rag somewhere.
So you just put it down around like your central character, like you don't cover that. You just it's just for background.
You could texture over your character too if you wanted. I just want it in the background, so I just put it where I want it. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You could do like like matte medium over the top of your drawing and texture that too if you wanted, but.
Yeah, I wasn't sure because, like I said, I've never used it or anything.
Yeah, I don't know. I did it on the last one, and it was kind of fun, so I thought I'd try it again. I have a tendency to overdo it, so I don't usually do it, but I'd give it another try.
It's got to kind of be a pain in the butt to paint on top of that, though, with all that texture.
Well, I usually do it only where I don't usually paint that much. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like on the Frankenstein piece, I did it like in the sky, like for the clouds and stuff. So it's sort of like I don't do a heck of a lot of drawing in there. So.
Yeah, it is a cool effect though. I'm actually kind of curious to try it out myself. I just don't know how that would work with an airbrush.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. It works almost best with an airbrush. It works less good with the parts where you got to draw and stuff. So.
Yeah, because it really is a cool effect.
I don't know,
man. You're making me want to try out things I've never wanted to try before. You're a bad influence.
Going to do some oil painting next? Yeah. I'm afraid to try the oil paints with like my normal thing because I'm afraid I'll like it too much and I don't want to do it. I just can't find a rag anywhere. I lost them all. Kind of ruined that one I was using with the texture stuff last night, so. I wonder where Pete's at. I bet he slept in. He's probably power napping like he told us last night.
Yeah, who knows how late he stayed up. I know I was up till after 1.
Like I might have seen a video from him like in my email when I started the show or something.
He finally got making videos.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I noticed that. Like when you guys did the hangout, I looked at his channel just to see if he had like new videos or, you know, what was the last one, and they're mainly hangouts, so. Which, I mean, yeah, me too. But.
Well, he just put up before I came on the show, I was just watching, he put up a new video.
Okay, yeah, that's more than what I've seen.
Yeah, it's his public declaration that he's open for commissions.
Oh.
That's probably why he's not here. His phone's ringing off the hook right now.
It'd be nice.
Cool. Well, I'm open for commissions, if anybody's out there. Might as well get on the bandwagon. How about you, Jay?
I'm always open for commissions.
I'll be open after this month.
I'm open, just no pet portraits, please.
Somebody mentioned going to the ferret store, actually, in the comments. Speaking of pets.
To what the ferret store? Store? What?
Yeah, Lindro Pazenti, I think his name is. Says, okie dokie, I'll go to the ferret store and be back in a few minutes.
All right.
The first comment. Cool. And somebody said,
start ferret already.
Yeah, the ferret.
Yeah, they're funny, man. The one that I had, like, it would always, like, hide the remote control or, like, the car keys. Like, one time, cool. I had to pull the entire refrigerator out because it got behind the fridge and, like, took the car keys behind there and, like, hit them.
You need to get one more and be, like, Beastmaster.
Dude, yeah, that's funny because that's the reason I wanted one in the first place, because of Beastmaster.
Yeah.
Actually, a guy that I worked with at the haunted house, they shot a movie and did the special effects on it, and what was that guy's name? That Mark Singer?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they said he's a huge drama queen on set, and a big jerk. Like, he brings his own makeup and stuff, and, like, he still had one of the cake wheels from Beastmaster. He's like, yeah, this is what they gave me my tan with. This is the tan color. And he gave it to him, and, like, the guy was all proud of it and everything at the haunted house. He's like, yeah, this was Mark Singer's.
Cool.
Yeah, I used to like that guy. He was also in V.
Yeah.
Yeah, I heard about that. I've never seen that show.
He was popular though. For a while there. I wonder what ever happened to him.
He got old.
Hitting the con circuit somewhere.
But evidently, if he's a drama queen like that, it probably was, you know, probably was hard for him to get work.
Right.
I don't want to work with this guy.
Eventually he catches up with you. Tim Phillips says hey in the chat.
Hey.
Super Killer's in the chat. Hey, Super Killer. I did find your message. Sorry about that. It was in the others folder. That freaking others folder on Facebook. I think it's ridiculous.
It's not like, and they don't give you like a notification about it either. Like, you just have to click on it and it'll, you know, it's like there's no way of knowing unless you actually go search for those messages.
Yeah, what is it now? Because I remember there's like messages or something on my page that that I don't always see and I have to go in and find them.
What? Yeah, it's like on your normal message, you know, like where like I instant message you like for the show to start the show and stuff.
Yeah.
Like right there, like if you look at the top of that little box, it says other, like where your messages are.
Uh-huh.
And then if you click that, it opens up a different folder with more messages from like people that aren't your friends and stuff, and you just never see it, you know?
Really?
Unless you click it. And I found it a long time ago, but then I forget, you know, to ever check it. And if you look in there, there's probably messages, because there was actually two or three more that I had missed also.
Oh.
Yeah, the sad thing is there's hardly ever any spam in there, and it's always like important stuff people wouldn't get work done.
Right? It's always something you wanted to see.
Well, that sucks because I get like friend requests and stuff from people that I don't really know, and I don't like usually if I don't know them, I don't honor it. But like if somebody messaged me and says, "Hey, I'm so and so, I wanted to follow you because," but if I'm not getting those, I don't know.
I used to be that way with my friends list because I have my art page too, but it's like with Facebook, no one hardly ever sees anything that I post on my art page. So I just started accepting everybody that sent me a request to a personal page.
Yeah.
And then if they're stupid, like if they post stupid shit on my wall, I just delete them. Like, I delete people I know too. As soon as I get like a game request, see ya.
Yeah,
me too. Come play Farmville. So Lendro, Venti's in the chat.
Yeah, come farm some shit.
Fucking living Farmville. But anyway, this Lindor guy jumped on my Patreon, so I want to tell him thanks.
Cool.
He's in the chat, so I appreciate that. I get gambling requests a lot. Mm-hmm. From my friends, they're always like my old high school friends, and it's like, come do this gambling game. I'm like, no, probably not.
I get a lot of those social game requests because I used to work on those type of games.
Yeah.
Like, come play Farmville or something. I don't know.
Candy Crush.
Yeah.
Mothman.
Yeah. I never played Farmville. Which ones did you invent?
Scott?
Yeah.
I don't know if I invented any of them.
Imagine, you probably invented them. Somebody else took the credit if you worked on them.
I worked on a game called My Town, which is like a city builder game. Mm. I worked on a game called Miscrits, which is like a Pokemon-style fighting game.
Yeah.
There's some other ones, but I didn't do as much on them. I worked on a game called Hero Conquest, which is like a superhero strategy game.
That's neat.
And then some other small ones for some other companies and stuff.
Do you still do that, Scott? Do you still make games and stuff?
I'm not doing it currently, but that's just because I was working on one project not too long ago, and they just decided they didn't want to do it anymore. So. But yeah, I still do that kind of stuff.
You ever been on one of those ones that like blew up and got super big?
Not Candy Crush big. Miskrits was pretty big. It's still, I mean, the company's pretty much one under, but I think there's still people playing the game and there's still, I think, a fan base around it. I don't know.
Yeah, that's neat. Very cool. I guess. Are they fun to work on? I mean, I have no idea about those games. Yeah,
I enjoy it. It's like, if anything, it's like, you know, like whatever it is, a movie or whatever. I mean, you come up with stories and ideas and concepts, and you draw them out, and you know, and then you execute it, and it's fun. I enjoy it. And you know, it's most of the stuff is kind of, you know, more of that cartoony style that I do anyway, so I enjoy it.
Yeah.
Well, I know that, like, you were talking about your work environment. Just definitely sounded like a cool place to work.
Yeah. That the first company I worked with was definitely like that. I mean, it was, you know, they got the ping pong tables and the, you know, basketball hoops, and you know, they got a energy drink machine where the drinks are all free, and the stock fridge and kitchen, and go out and, you know, every month you go out and play laser tag or do some kind of event outside of that. And then towards the end they started a 4-day work week.
God.
Yeah, it was fun while it lasted. You know?
Did you say they went under?
What's that?
Did you say that company went under? Or?
Yeah, they just started, you know, scaling back and laying people off, and I made it through a couple rounds of layoffs, and then I got laid off, and they lasted for another, I think year and a half. I mean, it just recently they finally, I think they just got to the point where, you know, they had to kind of close up shop. Because I went to a wedding with one of the guys that I used to work for. He was laid off a while back, but all the people that were still there, they eventually, you know, they pretty much told me it was over, and they had either new jobs or were looking for new jobs. So.
But
you're only as good as you gotta have. When they started off, they were, you know, they kind of get on the ground floor with those Facebook games, you know, before a lot of people were doing them, and they had, you know, the My Town, that was like the first city type builder game where you know, kind of like a Sims type thing where you build towns and things like that. That was pretty successful. And then the next one they did was the Pokemon style fighting game, Miskrits, and that was successful. And then, I don't know, the other ones after that just didn't catch as, you know, they didn't catch on as much, so.
Yeah. Imagine that would be a tough, like, you know, business to be in.
Yeah.
You know, do hit after hit. I mean, Chris Kitts in the chat says, "Hey, guys."
Hey, Chris.
How do you get work doing that kind of stuff?
Well, I started off, I had one client, and eventually he came back and started a game company himself, and that's who I was working for just recently. But I started off, and it was just mostly referrals, you know, I had, for some reason, I started working with, like, people out in Florida, and they kept referring me to other people. So I have a lot of like clients out in Florida. But so anyway, I started working with this one guy out there. You know, not living out there, but just, you know, working remotely. Yeah. Doing emojis or emoticons, the little happy face things.
Oh yeah.
For Facebook, and at that time, that was years ago. I didn't even know what Facebook was, and he told me, "You get on Facebook, and I'll send you a friend request or whatever."
Yeah.
I got on, and I did that for a little bit, and then after that, I really never used Facebook again. And then I think I just came across an ad for this game studio, and I had that other work, and you know, I had done some work on Facebook stuff, so I sent them that, and I think they said they had like about 300 applicants, and they picked two of us, me and this other girl, and then that's kind of where it started. But they, you know, we did a little test and everything, and you know, got hired doing that. And like when I got hired, they asked me if I was a gamer, and I said, well, honestly, not really, you know. They said, well, that could be a good thing or a bad thing. I mean, it could be good because maybe you'll bring something fresh to it, and it could be bad because you're not familiar with it. But
yeah.
I guess in the end, they figured it was a good thing. You know, I worked there for a good 3 years or so.
Hmm.
And probably
it's was still like there. In that respect, it's like if there's any bad habits they don't want you to have, they don't have to untrain you.
Like what do you mean?
Like if you were going in with experience and they were looking for something fresh, then they wouldn't have to teach you all the things that you know did want you to do and have to like basically unlearn those habits.
Yeah. Well, it's like when you're freelance, I mean, you kind of have to match different styles and stuff anyway. So I was never super fond of that.
Yeah,
I would definitely, you know, even though I definitely like, you know, working on my own and everything, but if an opportunity like that came up, I'd do it. I mean, it was just, I like it because you're actually working with other people, you know, and
yeah.
Before we started doing these art casts and stuff, it's just like you kind of work in a vacuum, and your artwork just improves so much when you have other people around you and you see other people doing cool stuff and everything like that, and everyone was there like super super cool, and I mean, it was just like a big family, and so if there was a situation like that again, I wouldn't mind doing it again, even though you know I'm getting spoiled again working for myself, but.
Yeah.
But yeah, I got after that I got hired onto another company and they were planning to be something like that. I mean, they were looking at this one facility that, you know, for the just the you know, uses the office and everything. And it was like an old not old, but it was I think it was a landscaping company. So they had it was like a landscaping company, a pool, a company, and they all kind of shared the same office. So they actually had a pool there, and they had like a basketball court and like all kinds of stuff like that. You know, it's like a showcase for all this, you know, outdoor stuff. So I mean, it would have been pretty cool, but they got their, and because these are all like startup companies, so they got their initial round of funding, and we worked there for about 3 months. And then the rest of the funding never came, and they're, you know, in lawsuits over it and everything. So that didn't last very long.
Oh, man. Yeah. Yeah, I know.
Were they planning to, like, go ahead, Jeff.
Well, I mean, why don't you go, actually? Mine wasn't important.
I was just gonna ask if they won those lawsuits, were they planning on reopening the company?
Oh yeah, they're well, the one guy that was the owner or the president or CEO or whatever, he's still out here because he's Italian and he came here from Italy to start up this company, and he I think he was kind of like a work visa or something like that, so I thought that he might get deported or something, but I think he's continuing to do some stuff, you know, on a small scale over here, so. But he called me not too long ago with a possible other project that never really came about, but yeah, he's still out here, so who knows, you know, you never know. I got an email from this potential client from like 7 years ago that was going to start something, and, you know, it got to the point where I like never heard from them, and they just emailed me back 7 years later saying they want to start it up again, so you never know, man. It's like
7 years.
It's crazy.
Yeah. It's like guys doing their comics 7 years later. Yeah, I'm still going to do that comic.
Yeah. Me too.
Yeah, well, we all got projects like that.
Unless you're one of those freaky guys gets their stuff done. That's pretty wild, though.
Yeah, the trick is just to, you know, kind of work with enough of those people where they either remember you or pass your name on to somebody else. And because when people ask, you know, how you make a living doing this, I mean, it's hard for me to say because I started so long ago, and most of the work I get now are just from, you know, people or referrals that I had a while back. So, you know, I mean, when I first started off, I was sending out promos and stuff, and that was just a whole different game back then. I'm going to have to probably start doing that again, sending out postcards. But I'm just going to start by just sending them to the people that I've already worked with, you know, just to remind them I'm out here and everything. And then after that, maybe look into some other stuff.
Yeah. Well, I mean, in a way, it's not that different than a lot of businesses, I think. You know, like when I painted and stuff, I'd always get those calls in the spring from people I already, you know, worked for, and then, you know, yeah. Then later you get more people, you know, but it's a build-up thing, you know? So.
Yeah, it's just, you know, it's hard. You know, I don't know, starting off now would be difficult, you know? Back then it seemed like it was easier to, you know, it was before, like, kind of globalization and, you know, the way the economy kind of crashed for a while and hasn't really picked back up since then. So, you know, it's tough. I mean, I think, you know, I just think with the internet and everything in general, there's so many other ways to go about it that we didn't have back then too. So there's definitely pluses and minuses.
Oh yeah, I agree.
You see all these people on YouTube, you know, making a lot of money doing art and stuff and getting their name out there that way, so.
Yep. Like, there's just there's all these things that, like, just weren't even there, like, 5 years ago now, you know?
Yeah.
It just seems like every time you turn around, there's, like, some new way that somebody's figured out to make money doing art. It's just, I think it's inspiring, really.
Yeah, you just gotta figure out how to do it yourself. That's
right. Gotta get that working for yourself. I was gonna say too, like when you're talking about having that like studio environment, like where you work with people.
Mm-hmm.
I always like that too, you know, just like that same kind of thing. But it's just like it's hard to find like some kind of job that you like going to where it's like that also. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. I was definitely lucky. You know?
Yeah.
So. Yeah, the scary thing is, I mean, it's just like nothing's, you know.
What? Permanent.
What?
Permanent. Like that. Nothing's permanent.
Yeah, I mean, there's no job security. I mean, you think about, you know, working for yourself and, like, how it's kind of scary because you don't know where your next check's coming from and stuff like that. But most jobs, you know, at least in this industry, you don't know that anyway, even if you're on, you know, staff or something. I mean, they can lay you off any time, and, you know, it's like,
yeah.
So it's, at least if you're doing your own thing, it's kind of your own fault.
So true.
I don't know, man. It's like, I know people, like, just any business, man. My neighbor, man, he's out of work. He's been out of work for a while, and, like, and he's getting, you know, he's getting older, and they just say they won't look at him, you know? He's like,
yeah.
You know? So, it's, yeah, it's tough.
I definitely felt that, like, being in construction, you know? Like, at one point, you're like the young gun, and everybody, you know, wants you, and then there's, like, a point when you start to get older, you know? And you kind of, like, notice, you know, that
yeah.
You might be getting kind of passed over.
I don't know, man. It seems like when I worked in construction, a lot of the young guys were just kind of goof-offs and you know.
Oh, yeah. That's how it is, too.
No, dope heads and stuff like that, but it's,
yeah.
But like, cause like my ex-father-in-law, he's still, you know, he's still doing construction, and like even his dad, he was doing it up until he died, and he was like, I don't know, like 75 yeah. or something. I mean, probably maybe older than that. I don't know. Just
we could definitely hang in there. Like in this last job I worked at, I worked for like a big company, so that's kind of more how I meant it. You know, because it's like, I don't know, you know, towards the end of winter when everybody started getting laid off and stuff, there was like the scramble to keep working and, you know, I don't know. But you're right, it's like, you know, like with construction, it's like you got like the knowledge thing helps you when you're older, you actually know something. Let's see. So Lindro says, I guess for a lot of artists, it's easier to promote themselves now.
Easier, yeah. Some ways, yeah. I mean, it's like I said, there's a lot of other people promoting themselves too in the same way, so it's...
Yeah. Yeah, there's definitely a lot more platforms to do it on, but I still think it's a lot of work involved in making those platforms, you know, successful in doing so.
Yeah, I think that it is like that. It's, like, easier, but then it's also, like, there's so much, you know, like, noise out there now, you know what I mean? Jump out there and there's just like a million awesome artists that you're like, I don't know, competing with a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Well, you guys aren't very talkative today.
Yeah, this stuff takes some concentration to get it right. So
yeah, super concentration mode right now.
Oh, come on, Brody, talk to me. I know you're not concentrating.
I've been talking.
I actually talked about construction and stuff. I actually did a painting job here on the golf course for a lady. Last week. That's why I missed the show a couple days. Of course, I missed the show all the time. So, but that was the reason then.
That's cool. Well, what did you pay?
Yeah, it was easy money. I mean, I've done work for the lady before, and she wanted her house painted and exterior paint, and it was easy money and a couple of days work. So, and it was right after I got back from that con too. So it was like, you know.
Yeah.
Just made sense to do it just so I had extra cash.
Yeah.
I think my girlfriend's mom and dad want their house painted. Like it's her dad's like in a wheelchair and he keeps banging up all the walls. So they repaint all this stuff. And so I figure I might help them do that or whatever. They said that, because she was saying, like, her mom knows how to sew, and maybe get just, like, trade where she could sew some of those bow ties for me, and I could paint their house. So.
Yeah.
I don't know.
That's cool.
I don't know. Like, it's a love-hate relationship. Like, sometimes I'm like, man, I hate painting houses. I never want to do it again. And then, you know, sometimes you're out there, and it's, like, you know, it's early morning. Like, I started, like, I think 7 o'clock before it got too hot. And it's just, like, just me and a paintbrush, you know? And it's kind of like the same thing I do. I don't know, like, the same approach I take to my own work. It's just, like, you want it to be perfect for the person. And it's kind of relaxing in a way. But maybe it's only relaxing because I know I'm getting a nice check at the end of it.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I don't think painting's
a bad... I wouldn't want to do it all the time.
I don't think painting's a bad job. I mean, I think if I didn't want to be an artist, I totally could have, you know, been happy being a painter. But... I don't know. Once you get that dang art bug, though, it's hard to be satisfied with your life, you know.
Yeah.
What did you do? Did you, you know, just cut and roll the whole outside, or did you spray it, or?
No, I actually brushed it all.
Brushed the whole thing. Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
The only thing I hate about it, really, is getting up, like, on a ladder high. It's like, I used to not, like, I don't want to say I'm afraid of heights, because I still get up on ladders and things like that, and I still ride roller coasters and all that good stuff, but it's like, as I get older, it's like, kicking in more that it bothers me more, I think, to do it.
Yeah. That's kind of like me, too. Like, when I was young and stupid and brave, I used to do a lot of dumb things, and I don't know, as you get older, you kind of realize that how you can get crippled, you know, doing some of that stuff. I don't know.
It's like a lot of my friends, like, snowboard and stuff during the wintertime. I don't do any of that, and it's like, and we have a new mountain bike park here, and
yeah.
I used to mountain bike all the time, but it's like, I'm so afraid I'm going to break my wrist or my hand, and since this is, like, all I do right now, it's just scary. I don't want to take a chance, you know?
Yeah. How old are you then, Brody?
28. I'm still pretty young. 28.
28? No, that's not young, dude. That's old.
Oh, thanks.
That's old.
Okay. Yeah. Unless you're 18, then it's old, right?
I mean, I feel a lot older. I guess, I don't know. I guess because I've had my own place and I've been married since I was, 20. So I feel a lot older than I am.
Oh.
What was that, Jay?
I said, oh. 20, you got married? Wow, that is young.
I think I was either 20 or 21 when I got married.
Oh,
really? July. July's going to be 8 years that we celebrate our 8th year anniversary, so.
Well, congratulations. Wow.
Thanks, man.
How come you got married so young?
You know, honestly, I just...
lost the will to live.
I don't really... What'd you say, Jay?
Lost the will to live.
Yeah, I was forced into it. No. It's funny, though, because everybody around here thought that, like, Brittany was pregnant and we were going to have kids. And I'm like, no, that's not why we got married. Because yeah. I guess that's, like, the typical thing here, you know? But, yeah, like, I don't know, man. I kind of went through the whole partying, drinking, and getting stupid stage from, like, the age of 16 to 18. So by the time I was old enough to do all that stuff, I didn't care about it anymore. And I was dating a girl, like, I want to say pretty seriously because we were in a long-term relationship for, like, 4 years before I got with my wife now. And I don't know. I was just always, I don't know, I guess maybe the way I was raised or just my own personal preference, I was just kind of like a relationship guy. And but this girl was older than me, and she was a nurse, and she didn't really dig the whole art thing. It was like a joke. Like, I wanted to always try to turn, like, art into a career in some shape or form. Like, at that point in time, I wanted to go to art school and all that, and she was just like, well, that's stupid, you know, it's dumb, it's a waste of time, it's not a real job, and that happened. And you can't be with somebody like that, you know, and we ended up splitting up, and me and Brittany were friends for a long time. We went to high school together, she was a year under me, she wanted to date me like the whole time we were in high school, but I never wanted to cross that friendship barrier because, you know, I appreciated her friendship, and me and that other girl split up. She was there, and it just led to a relationship, and been together ever since. And I don't know, she's like 100% supportive of this whole art thing, and it's like I don't think I could find anybody better to be with. So it was like just made sense to make it permanent. Yeah. We were living together, and we shared a bank account and all that stuff anyway. So it was just like, you know, might as well make it official.
I still can't get the shared bank account thing to work.
I have words of wisdom about that, but I'm not going to share it on air.
I was going to say, being an artist, I kind of like I need money most of the time more than she does. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, the worst guys have a little, you know, things to say about that. No, but yeah, like my girlfriend and I, we still split everything, you know, right down the middle. Even if we go to a movie or something, and we don't fight about money at all.
Yeah.
No, it's weird because I'm not making a whole lot of money as an artist right now. Like it's getting better as time goes on, but I've only really been doing it for a year. But it's like financially I think I've touched base on this on the show before, but financially we're stronger now that I'm doing this than I was when I was working like a corporate job for the hospital. And I guess it's just because I'm not driving there every single day, like an hour or two and from over the mountain. I'm not putting all that wear and tear on the vehicle and all the repairs and like tires and oil changes and all that stuff. So, because that stuff adds up pretty quick.
Yeah, it definitely. You do spend money going to work. I noticed that every year when I would get like laid off and, you know, in the winter time and stuff, and it would just be like we could just skate by on like so little, you know. And then as soon as you get working, you're like, oh, thank God, money again. And then, but you're just like spending so much more, getting back and forth to work, and you know, I don't know. What? How old were you when you got married, Jay?
26, I believe.
That's still pretty young.
26 or 27. I don't really count anymore.
Right.
Yeah, it was all one big picnic.
Yeah. You must have liked it for some
reason. Oh, yeah. I've told you about it. It was all it was all roses until one fateful day.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that answers my next question then.
Yeah, you want to know about it? We'll talk about it off air.
Oh, yeah. I was just going to ask if you're still married, but I'm not trying to.
Oh, no. I've been divorced for 2 years now.
Got you.
Oh, you know what? Actually, it's funny. I had a message yesterday. It was Kevin Phillips, and he said that I keep mentioning Kevin Phillips in the show, and I thought, and I was like, I don't remember mentioning Kevin Phillips, and he said that he thought that I was talking about Kevin Cross, but I just realized that there's a guy named Timothy Phillips in the chat, and I bet he thought I was saying Kevin Phillips instead of Timothy Phillips.
Probably, yeah.
Yeah.
Or he just mixed the two together, because we do talk about Kevin a lot of the time.
Yeah, we do, but I was thinking that, and I just kept racking my brain yesterday, and I was like, I don't really remember mentioning Kevin, but anyway.
Well, I should see if there's a way that we can get a transcript of what we say during the show and make it available for the public.
Actually, if you refer to line C,
anyway, let's see. Tim says, I relate to Brody. Oh, that's I don't know about that. A lot of my career choices were ended by my fear of heights. That's interesting. It also exposes a myriad of issues related to art, like art college students undercharging for their work. Sorry, I think I skipped a comment there. Back in there, they were talking about it's easier for artists to promote themselves now.
kind of interesting those career choices were that were ended.
Yeah, I was going to read the rest of them here. It says, even as a mechanic, I hated climbing on heavy trucks when I was up high. Tim says that. He's the one who doesn't like heights. I had to quit the Army because I couldn't do heights. Scared of heights, electricity, and gas, so my career... Our crew of manly stuff is out. I'm scared of electricity too. I don't want to grab one of that stuff. Anyway.
Yeah, I've been shocked pretty good. I used to do maintenance for a tanning company on the, on the beds. I basically break them down, clean on the first bulbs, that kind of shit. And one time I changed the bulbs on the stand up bed and, I turned the power off on that room when I was doing it, and I put the bulbs back in, flipped the power back on to check all of them, and there was one bulb that wasn't pressed in all the way, and instead of walking all the way to the back, I figured, well, I'll just open it back up and pop it in, and it's like a fluorescent, one of those long tube bulbs, and I accidentally touched the metal part that connects to the prongs or whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah. My arm was like sore for like 4 days.
Yeah, we won't do that
again. My grandfather was always had good stories.
Yeah.
Dangerous stuff. Look at that.
Yeah, definitely. I remember this one time I dropped the screw, the screw that's on the cover, back. I had the cover off. And I dropped the screw, it just like sucked right into the hole, right next to the outlet. So I like was trying to get a hold of that screw, but I was trying not to touch the, the little posts on the outlet. I took my screwdriver, I stuck it in there. And I accidentally touched the post of that screw of the outlet, and it's like that'll wire shot out there. Yeah.
Well, it had like a plastic handle or whatever, so I didn't get shocked, but there was just like this loud noise, like a bang, like that. And then it welded the screwdriver tip to the outlet thing.
Oh, man.
I had to pull it off of there. And of course, hit the breaker, There's this guy watching me, he's like, careful there.
My mom always tells me that she knows that I was going to be an artist at a young age because I tried to stick a paintbrush into a wall outlet.
Yeah. Kids are just attracted to outlets for some reason.
I remember when I was a kid. My little brother, I was sitting on the couch, and I remember my little brother, he sat there, and he literally had like a butter knife from the kitchen. Walked into the living room, right up to the outlet, and I'm watching him, and he's looking at me with this goofy smile, like, look at me, I'm going to stick this in the outlet, and I just kind of smiled back, like, knock yourself out, dude. He stuck it in there, and he got shot across the living room. His shoes were still in front of the wall, like... And I remember he just looked at me for about 5 minutes with this absolutely like deer in headlights kind of look. I don't know if he was like temporarily paralyzed or what. And he finally got up. I was like, you idiot,
Yeah.
And there was all this black smoke around the outlet, like it singed the drywall and all this shit. Oh, God.
And my little brother, I don't even know how old he was. He was really, really little, but he ended up crawling up on the counter in the kitchen and trying to try to make Pop-Tarts in the toaster, but he put them in the long way, and he actually tried to use a butter knife. My mom called him in time, but he was trying to use a butter knife to pry him out of there. So, wouldn't have been good.
Yeah. Toasters are dangerous. I remember, at my dad's house, when I was younger, we had this toaster, and it wouldn't pop up, So you had to, watch it and pop it up. It's, so dangerous, And, we were just all used to it. And then my younger brother, who's, my half-brother, so he didn't actually live with us, he was over. He's like, put some, Pop-Tarts in there or something. And, then he comes, running in the living room. He's like, Jeff, the kitchen's on fire.
Oh, no.
I go walking in there, or running in there, and there's, like, just flames shooting out of that toaster, just, like, going up, and then they're, like, hitting the bottom of the cabinet, and, like, lighting the cabinets on fire. And I was just like, oh, my God. So I just, like, I grabbed it by the cord, just, like, unplugged it, and just, like, took, you know, carried it by the cord and threw it outside. But I was just like, damn.
Yeah, you're bringing back so many memories. One time I tried to make ramen noodles in the microwave, but I forgot to put water in the bowl.
What's that do, actually?
Oh, I did microwaves that. Weird. I did that with something, too. It might have been ramen noodles, but, yeah, that was not good.
Wait, what happened? Did it catch on fire or something?
Yeah.
Oh, it just cooked, like, yeah.
It just catches on fire?
Yeah, they like the noodles completely got charred black, and it was like smoke billowing out of the microwave. Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. I always hear people talking about ramen noodles. We have no such thing here. I don't even know what they are.
Maybe they're called noodles. You don't. They're like. You don't have any kind of noodles like that. I mean,
yeah, you get cup noodles.
Like what is it exactly? Like spaghetti or something, or?
Well, no, it's more like they got different flavors, like chicken and beef and shrimp and everything. But they're like these little kind of square, like a brick of noodles that are like, I guess, dehydrated, or they look like they're dehydrated.
Oh, okay. You know what? We do have them. Yeah, they're not called ramen. What do we call them? Mr. Noodle or something like that. You guys actually eat that shit?
Yeah, man.
Sometimes they come in like a little cup.
The thing is, it's like super cheap. I mean, you can get, you know, I don't know, 12 of them for a buck or something like that. But the trick is if you like add stuff to it, you know, add some vegetables.
Make it gourmet.
No, seriously, yeah.
No, they're actually not bad, Scott. What I used to do, I used to take the flavor pack out and put them in a pot on the stove. And then once they heated up and got soft, add some cheese, or like some Velveeta cheese to it. It's pretty good, actually. Yeah. It's a college kid and artist's best friend.
I don't know about that, man.
So like the gross thing was my friend was staying with me for a while. He like separated from his girlfriend, so he like stayed with me for a while, and him and his kid. And his kid would just eat them and not cook them. He would just open up the box. And eat them.
Oh.
That's
holy
cool.
Crap!
Oh man,
that sounds horrid. Yeah, I don't know. I tried to trick myself into thinking that I could make those things taste good, but I think ultimately there's just no way to make them taste good.
It's noodles, man. How can you go wrong with
them? I don't mind them. I actually think they're pretty good sometimes. These ones are the best. Or the shrimp.
Yeah. I remember, like, when I moved out, my mom bought me this, like, huge case of those. And I, like, packed them around for, like, I had these, like, case of noodles for, like, years. I never ate them. They just go apartment to apartment with me.
The world's tough out there, Jeff. You're going to need these to survive.
That's right. I don't know. I figured, yeah.
Used to like to go to Costco and buy like bulk shit, so I guess he saw that case and at least he won't starve to death.
Well, they probably consider too, like, we're guys and we're not going to cook, so it's easy, you know, toss something in the microwave.
So Chris Kitt says his first house fire was due to a toaster also, exactly as he described. His older brother.
I don't want to ask how many after he had after that. That was his first.
Yeah. And then Lindro says they have rice flour pasta. Rice flour pasta. I never heard of that.
Is that any good? Or is that what's delicious.
It must be where he's at.
Yeah. I had to make some chili last night after Jay talking about the chili.
Yeah, I think I'm gonna make some this weekend.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know the sad thing is I was talking about all the chili and I never even made it. I just got caught up working.
Oh man. I think I'm gonna
change that today.
Being like single, do you really? Because like I noticed like as soon as like if my wife goes like out of town or anything like that, like, I always cook dinner, and I just cook, like, a nice dinner and stuff, but it's like, as soon as she's gone, I go back to my old ways of just, you know, I don't hardly cook anything for myself. I'm just like, oh, there's, like, a block of cheese and some bread. I'll just eat that, you know?
Yeah, no, it's true, though. I'm really bad for that, you know, and especially, you know, working the hours I do.
Yeah.
9 times out of 10, when I'm done at night, like, I'll grab the dog, throw him in the truck, and I'll go grab a cheeseburger down the road. Like, I just can't be bothered cooking.
That was huge about eating out when I was single. Qdoba.
Yeah, like there's a Subway down one side of the road, and there's an A&W cheeseburger on the other side of the road, so...
Mm. You can't beat Chipotle, man.
Those A&Ws, I don't know, like, what the one, like, where you live is, but, man, we used to have one here that was, like, really good.
Yeah, they are pretty good, but yeah. I know, Christ, if I don't... I gotta stop eating there as much as I do, because I'm starting to wear it.
Right. That's the bad bit.
But it's just so... It's like you say, though. It's like, am I going to spend 2 hours making a meal just for myself? Yeah, odds are not too often.
Yeah.
At least if I make chili, I can just put it in a, you know, a container, and I can munch on it all week. So.
Exactly.
Yeah. We don't hardly eat all of it, so I got the same way. I got my lunch for the rest of the week.
Yeah. Oh, ramen noodles are made with rice. Somebody said that in there. And then Tim Phillips says, raw ramen is awesome.
I don't know, man. You guys got some funky taste buds down there.
And then Jesse says, ramen noodles makes him gag.
I tell you, it's like, I don't like them. I just don't. They don't seem like normal noodles to me. Like, there's something up there, you know?
No, that's not real food.
And none of the things you said.
That's like the only thing that wouldn't go bad in canned, in whatever's in cans.
That's true. But you said that, you know, like you put Velveeta cheese on them or whatever. I also hate Velveeta cheese. I think that stuff is so gross.
Isn't that like that processed cheese slice stuff?
American cheese.
I don't know what Velveeta is. It's like different than American cheese, but I know that I've had some in the fridge for like 2 months now, and I just checked it the other day, and it's not even molded.
Yeah,
no, it's not cheese.
Yeah, not
I'm like, yeah, that's still good. I'm like, does it smell normal? That's still. I have to put down some ramen.
Yeah. Wow. My mom got into making goat cheese a while ago, and that's pretty interesting, like, that whole process. Could you, like, age it? And you just, it's, like, sitting around for, like, ever. And then she's like, yeah, it's getting better and better. You know, just like, are you sure it's not just rotting?
You know, at the rate we're going, I think I'm going to be skipping lunch today.
We did this to him yesterday, remember?
And then Tim Phillips says, my ex-wife had to have organic everything. She sends me emails telling me what to feed our kid. And,
it doesn't stop after you get divorced if you have kids.
Yeah, I would imagine. He says, I'm used to scrounging growing up, very poor, used to eat the neighbor's leftovers. Yeah.
Oh, man.
My ex-girlfriend was like that. She just was like Whole Foods lady and, you know, could never buy anything cheap or good, you know. I hated that.
It's like, come on, I just want to eat some Cheetos once in a while, lady. She was like one of those vegetarians who would like, you know, like I'm a vegetarian, but then would like, you know, totally eat steak and stuff. Never quite understood that one.
My friend is a, what is it called? Not Episcopalian, Pescatarian? Uh-huh. Pescatarian or something like that?
What is that?
He doesn't eat any meat, like no animal products except for fish. That's it.
Mm.
No eggs, no meat, just fish stuff. And then, you know, vegetables on like that shit.
Well, that's just like picking on the fish.
It was like 30 people. Yeah.
inside.
I'd always get like a big sticky souvenir from him. He didn't like me.
I would have a hard time eating fish here. There's just not much fish, you know, like Colorado.
At least ocean type fish, anyway. To get it fresh, it always, you know, I'm like skeptical when I see it at the grocery store. Like, how long did that ride a plane for to get here?
Oh, you don't eat tuna or anything?
Oh, no, we do. Yeah, we eat the canned salmon and stuff a lot.
Yeah.
I like that.
Sorry, guys, I got to step away for a minute. I just got a client walking through the door.
Okay. Jay actually left just because we're grossing him out. But.
Yeah. I'll come back in 10 minutes when you're done talking about food.
Yeah. The dang chat, it's like once the chat starts going, I notice I slow down because I'm sitting here looking at the chat over and over. Government cheese is the best. I can live on that. Does anybody know what government cheese is?
Well, yeah, it's like, I guess it's the cheese you get, like, you know, when you're, you know, on government assistance or something. But yeah. I guess I don't know exactly what it tastes like or what's different about it.
Hmm. That's interesting.
And then macaroni and cheese is what Americans eat when they want to die slowly. Lorendo said that. I actually like macaroni and cheese, but I like make it, you know? I can't eat stuff out of the box. That stuff's horrid.
Yeah,
agreed. But yeah, like, yeah, I guess that's. Yeah, Kevin might show it back up. He just messaged me, says going out for breakfast and come back on if we're still around. So he might come into the after show. Tim Phillips says can't get food stamps or government insurance because I'm a dude and I only. At joint custody of my kid. That's too bad.
I ran into like an issue like that when, like, because there was a time like I had no money, so I went just to see if I could get like, you know, money for like groceries and stuff because I had three kids, but they wouldn't
have all been there.
Yeah, because my ex made money and they wouldn't like, they said we had to. Forgot what it was, but like I said, well, just can't you give it to me for like one of the kids, you know?
Yeah.
But no, I mean, if you couldn't like split the kids up or there's some weird thing. Yeah, it was like, it was kind of a pain.
Yeah, that whole system is like really ass backwards.
Yeah.
In a lot of ways.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, like when I used to. Or go ahead.
Oh, no, go ahead. What were you going to say?
It's not that great of a story. But, yeah, like when I get laid off, you know, we could get unemployment in the wintertime at that last company I worked for if we wanted it. And it was like the amount of hassle. You know, it was like $125 a week or some goddamn thing, you know. It wasn't even enough to, like, bother with. And I hate any of that kind of stuff. Where you gotta like freaking go beg for something and
it sucks, man. Anyway, go ahead, bro.
I was just gonna say like it's kind of like off topic, but me and Brittany have been married 8 years, but now we're just finally starting to talk about having kids, you know?
Yeah. You should do it. Have 8 kids.
What'd you say?
You should have 8 kids.
Well, yeah, right.
How many are you going
to
have?
But like, I might change my mind after the first one. I don't know. I don't know how many people plan on having 2 and then change their minds.
I don't know. I think we probably have another one if we're younger. I don't think we're getting older, so Tristan probably it, but
we'd started earlier, we probably would have had another one. But just the thought of, like, going through all that stuff again, like going to the hospital again, you know, all that kind of thing, it's like, oh, man.
Yeah.
Buying diapers again, you know. All that fun stuff. I don't know, it's good, though.
But that's the thing, is like once you have kids, then you'll be like the, you know, since you're already home doing your art, you're going to immediately probably go to the stay-at-home dad role.
Yeah, that's what Brittany was saying. Like, she wants me to do that. And I was like, well, aren't you going to want to stay home? Like, isn't that going to affect you? And she's like, I couldn't stay home. She's like, I'd get bored and lose my mind and all that stuff. She's like, at least when you're home, you have something that keeps you busy the whole time. She's like, I don't have anything like that. And I was like, well, there would be a kid to keep you busy.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. That's what she wants. I kind of feel selfish about the whole thing, you know. But that's just me kicking my own ass.
Yeah. You mean as far as staying home and working on your art instead of going to the normal job? Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if you could make it work, though, you know, and you're bringing in money.
She's been after doing this for a long time, and it's just like I always was like, no, because I just didn't believe in myself enough, I guess. And when I left the hospital, I was supposed to open a gym with a coworker, and that fell through, so I didn't have a choice, and that's how this all came about, and I've been doing it ever since. So,
yeah.
I just wish there was more opportunities to, like, exhibit and stuff. Like, we were talking about cons yesterday. I wish there was closer cons. Like, a lot of the libraries in Richmond where they do those shows, they do, like, comic cons, like, smaller cons at their library. And even stuff like that is good exposure for the people that are local to that area, you know, so that people, you know, recognize their name and see them when they go to the bigger shows. So I wish there was stuff around here that I could do, but there's really not. There's nothing. Like, there's galleries and stuff, but they're mostly, like, pottery and fine artists.
Yeah.
And, you know, I walk in there and I'm, like, the weirdo. Like, my stuff's, like, I don't know. A lot of older adults run those places, and they don't really get entertainment art or comic art. I don't understand it.
Yeah. Is there any, I know, like, here in, like, Denver or whatever, like, I live in Boulder, but, like, in Denver, there's, like, this co-op gallery. Well, there's a bunch, but there's this one I'm thinking of, and, you know, it's like a collective of a bunch of artists, and then they have, like, weird kind of shows, you know, kind of more, I don't know, theme type shows and stuff, and, like, you can enter those and show, and you could also, like, just join in the gallery, and, like, you could, you know, it's almost like buying into a space there, but, you know, you can hang your work. And is there anything kind of like that where, you know?
No,
you
can, see, that's what I wish there was stuff like, I'm into the art shows where they have, like, DJs or music or, like, you know, like, the atmosphere is created to exhibit what's, you know, or to match what's being exhibited there. But around here, it's just, like, hang stuff on a wall, rent a space kind of thing. And even then, like, when you rent a space, you can't just go on and be like, okay, I want to rent a space and whatever work, you know, whatever you want in. They have to look at your portfolio and say, okay, you know, this is going to fit in here or it's not. And this one gallery, like, the coolest one, like, you can't even just rent the space. Like, to rent the space, you have to, like, volunteer to work, like, one weekend a month there or something like that.
I think that is actually how this one is here also. It's like you got to, like, work a little bit to... Which kind of sucks.
I mean, it's fine, but I'd rather just pay the fee and just not have to do that.
Yeah, I don't know. That would be my only thing. Like, I don't know. You're saying, like, if you could find, like, a spot or something, that might work, but I don't know.
Like, I've sent like, portfolio stuff via email to, like, and some links to my work to some galleries that are in, like, L.A., and, I think one was in Arizona, and they focus on, and I think one was in New Mexico, but they focus on, like, comic style art and pop art and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I've never heard anything back from them, so.
There's actually two galleries I know of that have, like, shows that you can enter. There's one called Creature Features. I sent some stuff over there. But I never got anything sold, so I never went back. That's, like, in California. And then there was, like, it's one in Florida that they did this show, like, for... supposed to be like a Frazetta themed show. They wanted me to be in that one. But I don't know, they wanted me like, you know, a $25 entry fee, and then like the freaking, you know, split just seemed too high to me, but I don't know. Maybe if you could deal with it, you know. There's like another one that's like seeking out people. Maybe I can give you the info later and see if you're interested.
Yeah, I've never shown at a gallery or anything, and I don't know. I mean, I don't know if it's worth doing or not, but something to look into, I guess.
Yeah, I don't know. You hear like other podcasts talking about them, and to me, it just I don't know. It seems like such a hassle. You got to get it framed. You got to get it shipped out there. You know what I mean? I mean, if you could sell it, then that's one thing. But I never had much luck selling them, so.
Yeah, I wouldn't mind doing like a gallery show where like if they feature you as the like the artist for the exhibit and they come in and it's like an event, you know, that would be cool to do. But I don't know how hard it is to get a gallery to do that for you.
Yeah, I don't know. The one that I was in at the Creature Features thing, it was like a Planet of the Apes themed show, so it was like all this Planet of the Apes art. And it was like a gallery opening, you know, when they opened the show. But I wasn't out there or anything, so I don't know. There was like people that took video of it, like online and stuff. So I got to see kind of what was going on, but you know.
Yeah.
Wow, that 3D effect is like rocking my eyeball, Scott. I just clicked on your thing, and I'm like, oh my god, look away. Wonder if I had like some glasses that would work right now. You know what I mean?
What's that?
I said I wonder if I had some glasses if it would work for me right now.
If you did, it might. Because the sample, I'm looking at it on the screen, so I'm sure over the internet it probably worked too.
Yeah.
It's actually pretty cool. I'm really I'm hoping people need it. You know? I mean, it's something I would probably want because it's just. Cool looking.
Totally.
It's just amazing make it yourself now.
Did you just copy the line art and then move it over a little bit and change the color?
Yeah, what you do is you create the line art or whatever, and I decided to throw some gray in it just to give it something else, but you duplicate your whatever you say, this little spaceship here. You make one cyan, one red, and then you make the register off a little bit. So you just select the red, and you move it one way, depending on whether you want it to go in the background or the foreground. And then you move the blue or the cyan in the opposite direction, and it'll pop out. The trick is like with this motorcycle, it's in layers. Like this first front part is one layer. The hands are a different layer. She's in a different. So it's like this motorcycle is pretty complex. The rest of it is just going to be one, you know, like these things are just one thing. But this one I wanted because that's kind of in the foreground. So.
And does it have to be pretty much black and gray or just like two-tone? It can't be full color?
No. Well, that's the thing because like most of the old movies that are when they had the black and, I mean, when they had the red and blue glasses, you know, most of them are in black and white. And then, like, recently, like, they tried to make newer movies like that where it was in color, and it just looks muddy because you're viewing through red and blue, and it just muddies up every other color. Like, that Spike, they made the Spy Kids 3D movie, Robert Rodriguez did, and it used the old technology mainly because that's before, you know, you could get those cool, you know, those 3D glasses to work on televisions, like home televisions. Because you need a special kind of there's a couple different techniques. One actually like flickers, and your eye doesn't catch it, so it's a constantly flickering between the two channels or whatever. But you know, before they started selling TVs that had that and the glasses and everything, you couldn't watch like the movies you would watch on the theater. You couldn't watch those at home because there's two different projectors projecting them, and you can't do that on a TV. So, so anyway, the Spy Kids, they used the red and blue glasses, but the movie was in color, and everything else looked kind of muddy, and it bothered me. So really, with this technique, the best way to do it is black and white. So I got to answer this.
Okay. In the chat, Jesse,
let me mute Scott. He always does that where he answers the phone and then we gotta listen to this whole conversation. Anyway, Jesse says, where are you located, Brody?
Virginia. Or does he want, like, my full address?
He wants to know where you're at in your house. You're, like, in the kitchen, in the bedroom, studio.
Oh, yeah, in studio. Virginia.
Virginia.
In the mountains.
That's cool. I live close to the mountains, right outside my door.
Yeah, I love it, man. But it's just, like I said, the only downfall is, like, trying to, like, I have the most untypical career interest for where I live.
Yeah.
And it's really not highly, I mean, a lot of people look down on it, too. Like, I hate to say that, you know, because I'm not trying to judge anybody. Like, it's like, if they're happy doing what they're doing, whether that's working at McDonald's or greeting at Walmart or working in a factory, that's awesome. They should be happy. But it's like, if you don't follow the typical scheme of things here and you try things out of the box, it's like, it's a joke to people. You know what I mean? Like, they're like, oh, what are you doing? You're like, well, I'm an artist now, you know, full time. And it's like, they kind of look at you like, you know, like you're full of shit, kind of. And it sucks, but that's the way it works. I don't know if that's everywhere or just like in smaller towns, smaller communities, but,
I think definitely smaller towns, but I think also everywhere. You know, it's an unusual thing to do. So people are going to be skeptical, I guess. I don't know. I don't think, like, you know, my family, I think if you asked them, I doubt they'd say I'm an artist. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm not sure. I mean, I know when I was doing sketch cards, I was like, talking to this guy that knows my brother, and he asked me what I was doing, and I'm like, oh yeah, I do art. I do these things called sketch cards, and he's like, oh, you know, he's like, I asked your, because he knew me from high school, and I used to draw in high school, and he's like, I asked your brother, you know, if you ever did anything with your art, and he said no, and I was just like, what? You know, just seemed weird to me. I'm like, well, what did he tell you I was doing? But I don't know.
Yeah, I clicked over to the chat to kind of see what everybody was saying too, and like what Tim was saying about how wives change their mind once they tell you like that it's okay to stay home and work for yourself as an artist. I haven't experienced that with my wife, and she actually, like, when people ask her what I do, she'll tell them that I'm an artist, and you know, it's, if they ask her how much I make, then it's simple, you know, it's enough to keep doing it. That's the best answer to give to anybody who wants to pry into it.
Right. Like $1 million a year.
Yeah. And really, people shouldn't give a shit anyway, because it's not like they're paying your bills, you know?
Yeah. But you know how people are. Everybody's got, you know, something. My wife is definitely supportive of me being an artist. She always has followed me on any crazy thing that I've tried, which is pretty amazing. I mean, you got to have that or it's just not going to work, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can't be with somebody that's not, that, you know, a partner that doesn't support your interests.
No, I mean, you know, or at least let you do them, you know. Whether they're, cause I mean, my wife's not really into art. I don't know. But yeah, she would, I don't, you know, she's always supportive on my side of it. Did I hear something in the background? I guess not. Thought somebody jumped in.
Hey guys, I didn't know. I was trying to talk and I didn't know I was muted.
I'm sorry. Yeah, I muted you because we could hear you on the phone. So.
Oh, all the way from downstairs?
Yeah.
I gotta get a better microphone. Sorry about that.
It's okay. Sorry, I just figured you probably didn't want us listening. So.
Yeah, that's weird. I didn't think it would pick that up all the way down there.
So. But I muted you, like, kind of quick, so maybe if you were talking, like, when you were going down the stairs or something, maybe I just got the first part of it. I don't know.
Oh, maybe. Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I was just saying I was going to say that, you know, it's a lot to ask, like, a significant other. Because, I mean, when you're an artist and you're passionate about it, you'll do it no matter what. But, I mean, when they don't really have that passion or everything, you got to... You know, it's kind of hard on them if you're struggling with it and everything. So, I mean, if you do find somebody that's that supportive and everything, that's a plus. But you can't really, it's hard to, like, expect it too much of somebody else, I guess.
Yeah, absolutely. Because, like you said, I mean, you're into it, you know, and it's your thing. But then it's, like, it's hard for them to understand.
Yeah.
I mean, my wife actually has said that kind of stuff to me, like, in the past, like, you know, just, like, why do you, like, you know, get up, like, when I used to work and stuff, and then I'd get up in the middle of the night, or, you know, I'd stay up, like, really late, you know, and just, like, miss sleep to do your work, and, you know, it's just, like, why not just come to bed, you know? I'm just, you know, I mean, I think she knows, but... I think she's just, you know, she's also like a normal person who, like, you know, sleeps at night. So. And I think it's also hard for her to, like, see it as, like, you know, like, this is what you do, so you, like, struggle to do it, you know? It's kind of like with her, I think it's, you know, you kind of take the job that's there. Like, you know, if there's no art jobs, you just do a different job. What's a big deal? So. I don't know. But I, you know, like, I know, like, when we first got together, she was, like, in school, and that was, like, a big pain in the neck, and, you know, trying to get her out of school and stuff was a big hard thing, so I think she still gets it, you know. So Jesse Cobb says he's in Roanoke. Is that in Virginia?
Oh, yeah, that's actually not too far from me. I'm about an hour north of Harrisonburg, so I think he's probably, like, 2.5 hours. Or so, something like that. Pretty close.
Yeah. It says, Lindro says, are you part native? What's that mean?
Is he talking to me?
I guess so. Lindro might be from out of the country, I'm not sure.
Well, my dad's, like, half Cherokee, yeah. So I guess.
Yeah.
I guess.
Then Sandra says the current 3D technology uses polarized lenses instead of the tinted glasses.
Yeah, there's a couple different techniques, I think, from what I hear. But yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if the ones on the actual TV are, like, polarized. They may be. I don't know. I don't know that much about it. I know a little bit about it.
We bought, like, a disc, but we don't have, like, the 3D TV, you know. But we bought, like, a Coraline disc, I remember. And it was in 3D. And it actually came with some, like, cheapy glasses.
Yeah, my dad's got one. It's fun to watch, but it's, like, I don't know. I don't know if I'd bother, you know, getting... I think my TV's old, but I think it was one of the first ones that actually had, like, the 3D thing. So I think it's 3D ready, but... I don't know. I just they're cheap enough now. The glasses, they used to be like a couple hundred bucks a glasses, but now they're pretty cheap. But still, I don't know.
Yeah, that's kind of how I am. It's kind of neat, but I don't know. It's just like I'm more into like what the story of the movie is and stuff, or if it's a cool movie. I don't usually, you know, pay for like the 3D version if I go to the theaters.
Yeah, I typically don't either, but with like this Mad Max movie, I had to. I was like, man, this is probably gonna be awesome.
Was it neater in 3D?
Well, I haven't seen it without 3D yet, so. Which I probably will. I'm gonna buy the Blu-ray as soon as it comes out. That's how much I liked it.
That's cool.
But I thought it was pretty good. A lot of people say it's darker and stuff. I guess I haven't seen enough 3D movies to compare them to like the regular versions, so I didn't really notice any difference except for like the 3D. I popped the glasses down a couple times just to kind of see what it looked like, and it was weird. Like just certain elements in the movie, like certain characters, were like blurry, and then the rest was like crystal clear. And then, you know, you throw the glasses on, and I guess that's the 3D kicks into it, but...
Oh, yeah. I'm sure that's having, like, the effect or whatever without the glasses. I mean, we went and saw, like, that... I think it was the Despicable Me, or, like, one of the Despicable Me, sequels or whatever, and... It was good. I thought the 3D, I mean, it looked awesome, really. You know, it was a lot better than, like, back when I was a kid and seeing, like, you know, like Ice Pirates in 3D. It was a lot better than that, but it's like, I don't know. I just kind of, you know, forgot that it was 3D after a while, so I just kind of felt like, you know, why bother getting the 3D, you know?
Right.
I don't know. But who knows? Oh, so maybe he was talking to Jesse. Actually, Jesse says he's not native to Roanoke, just moved here from Florida a few months ago. So, yeah, and Linda says I was actually asking Jesse. Sorry. Didn't really intrude on your guys' conversation. And then Tim Phillips says, I fought about my art with every girlfriend I ever had. You need to get some good girlfriends, dude. Don't go out with the pretty ones who don't like art. Gotta find a nerd girl at some con.
Just like start hanging out in galleries and picking them up there.
That's right. Go to the cons and get with some cosplay chick. Amazing.
Well, a lot of cons, they do like speed dating at a lot of conventions now.
Speed dating?
Yeah, seriously, they'll do it like on the con, like they'll have like a section where the panels are, or in like the lobby area where they'll do like they'll have tables, and you get like 2 minutes per table or whatever with whatever person sitting there, and then you switch.
That's weird.
Which I guess it's kind of cool. I guess if it's for people who have the same interests to try to meet, because I'm sure it is kind of hard to find people, you know, in your regular day-to-day life that are into the same things as you if you go to conventions all the time and or into cosplay.
Oh, that's probably true.
So, to each their own, whatever helps them find love.
So the speed date, it's 2 minutes? I mean, what is it? I don't understand.
Yeah, I'm not sure how long it is, but from what I understand is, like, they have tables set up with different people, and you have, like, an allotted amount of time to, like, sit there and chat with that person, and at the end of that, like, before you switch, you can decide if you want to, like, get that person's contact information or not.
Interesting.
So that way you can follow up. And I'm not sure if it cycles back around. I'm not sure if, like, a lot of times, too, from what I understand is, if the time comes up, you can switch or you can choose to stay at the table you're at. If you're having like a connection with the person there. I've never done it. I just have read about it. I'm not even sure if I'm even describing it correctly. But
that's interesting. Yeah.
I guess just a way to meet some people. But it's kind of cool. Don't have to think of like a reason to go over and talk to them then. Yeah, that Mad Max piece is coming out pretty good there, Brody.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate that.
Alright. You put that one up on eBay or something, or?
Yeah, I'm probably gonna make prints of it and then throw the original up on eBay.
Yeah.
Yeah, this picture I'm using of Tom Hardy, it's like, it really doesn't. Unless you've seen the movie or are familiar with him as an actor, it like kind of throws you off when you first look at it. Because I looked at it and it really looked like, honestly, a cross between him and Mel Gibson. And I just kind of thought that was a cool piece because, you know, of the original Mad Max. So that's why I chose it.
Yeah.
Now, I like choosing pictures, too, that are kind of unconventional that I don't think a lot of people are going to use.
Yeah. I like to do that mostly, but I don't know. It's hard to do that all the time.
It was hard for this one because the movie, like, it had just came out, so there wasn't a lot of, like, stills from the movie and stuff on the internet. So it was hard to find decent.
Yeah.
Decent one.
I've actually kind of found, you know, when you do some movies that are just sort of, like, new and they're, you know, it's almost like, sometimes, like, when you're doing the new movies, it's, like, it's kind of before the fan base kind of develops, you know? Like, Guardians of the Galaxy, you know? It's, like, you go see that, it's a cool movie, but not everybody knows it yet before, you know? I don't know. But that's, like, with the Mad Max one, you know? Because I didn't know that actor before this movie, so, like, when I looked at your piece, I didn't actually recognize who it was, but it's just because I didn't know. I don't know him until I saw him on the commercial.
I don't think Scott recognized it yesterday either until I started, like, that it was Mad Max until I started drawing this, the villain down here.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I guess for me, I don't know, Tom Hardy, like, I just guess I haven't seen him enough, and it seems like, and I've seen him in stuff, like, well, obviously you see him in, like, as Bane, but you don't know what he looks like because he's got the mask on through the whole thing.
Right.
And, you know, and I saw him in some other, like, I think it was a boxing stuff that he was pretty good at, but I haven't seen him enough where I could, like, recognize him, so. But how I look at it, it's pretty dead. It's pretty dead on. It looks like him.
Yeah, I think it looks like him.
Appreciate it.
But yeah, I'm sure it's like that movie gets popular and it's, you know, becomes a hit. Everybody's going to be looking
doing fan art stuff. But yeah, I think one of my problems too when I do like entertainment art, like I'll pick shows or like movies that are like way past their prime, and I need to start doing stuff before movies come out. Like try to find like promo pieces or photos to use to do art so that I have stuff that's out. You know, that's ready for purchase when that movie comes out and everybody's, like, buzzing about it, or, like, immediately after. So that's why I'm doing something now, because it seems like a lot of times I'll pick shows that are, like, you know, the season or the series has ended, like True Detective with, like, Woody Harrelson and Matthew McConaughey. I did that piece way late. But, you know, I try to pick stuff that's got, like, a cult following, too, like, things that stay around years after, like Fight Club, for example. I mean, people still... You know, fans about that. I mean, the original Mad Max, like, those are classics. Alien, Predator, all that, you know. Those films fan base lasts forever, so.
Yeah. Even though they're old, there's people still want stuff in that. So I painted a Fight Club one a while back, and man, it took me forever to sell that sucker.
Really?
Yeah, you know, I was just, I did it actually because I was kind of looking. It's on my website somewhere. But it's, you know, like, you look around, like, eBay, you know, just, like, what people's drawn, and it was, like, totally, you know. I noticed there's just all this, like, Angelina Jolie, Brad Pitt artwork everywhere. And I thought, well, I'll try a Brad Pitt one. And it kind of backfired on me because it just took me forever to sell that thing. So, but I loved it. I like Fight Club a lot.
And that was right when that Snatch movie came out. I thought that was a great movie.
Yeah. Not like a super huge bad Brad Pitt fan, but I did like him in that.
Yeah. I'm actually a pretty good Tom Hardy fan. Like,
yeah.
He was in a movie called Bronson. I don't know if anybody's ever seen that. He was like a prison. He was like a con in a prison. Based on like a true story. But he goes by Charles Bronson. That's what like the inmate goes by. I forget his real name. But he's bald in that movie. And he has like a handlebar mustache. And he's just like beats everybody up basically in prison. But he did a really good job in that. And then of course he was in Inception.
Inception?
Yeah.
Who was he in Inception?
He's one of the guys, the like the mind travelers or whatever, I think.
Yeah.
Friends with Leonardo DiCaprio or whatever.
He's like in with, okay.
Yeah, he's one of the suits, one of those guys.
I guess I just didn't recognize him.
There's actually a scene in that people have said, like, he sounds just like Bane, like, the Bane voice. Like, he's in the car, and he's, like, talking, and he sounds, like, whatever he says, he sounds like Bane.
Yeah.
Like, that high-pitched. But. Yeah, I'm actually doing this, Jeff, I'm doing this on that board. That.
Oh, on MDF?
Yeah. But I'm still afraid to paint it. Like I'm just doing like black Prismacolor and white Prismacolor, and then like I'll use like an opaque marker and some like a wet paintbrush and like smear it around, or use some white acrylic for highlights, or like this white like gel pen. Hmm. I'm just afraid to paint it. Like I'm afraid I'm gonna mess it up.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know.
Or sometimes, like, I feel like I do too much. Like, for example, like, this area, I could probably come in with some pigmented acrylic ink or, like, just acrylic black paint and darken it. But then I'll feel like it needs to go other places to kind of balance it out. And I'll, like, sometimes I'll go overboard and it just kind of ruins a piece sometimes, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I agree.
It's easy to do.
Like, when you do pieces, like with that, like, are you gonna paint it completely, or like, do you leave the board for the skin tone, and like, how do you approach it?
Well, you know, like the board is brown, so I do use that a little bit for the skin mainly, because that it is kind of a nice base for the skin, but I still spray over it. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So it does give you that kind of a middle tone. And of course, it's like, since I do such a detailed drawing, you know, it's like, it is like a tone drawing. So it's like all the color is like transparent color that goes over it. You know what I mean? So like with her hair, it's like her hair's all done, but then when I put the red, you know, transparent color over it, it's pretty much like all the tones are there already, you know? So it's not like I paint black over the black. You know what I mean? I might come back and darken it back in, but it's like, I'm not like repainting it.
Well, if you're using acrylics, though, how are you? I don't, and this is probably going to be a dumb question, and it's mostly because I just don't have any experience with acrylic, but how are you making it transparent? Because I know I can do that with watercolor, but how are you doing it? Because that's just how they are already, you know?
You mean with the transparent,
like, yeah, the like, washes? How are you making it so that all your line work and stuff is still, like, visible through your paints?
Well, I mean, it's just, you know, like, if you just put some water, you know, like, let me show you over here, this isn't quite ready to paint, like, this is, like, where I scribbled on it, you know what I mean? So, mm-hmm. If I hit this with, like this, like, with the black, it's just watered down, you know what I mean?
So you're kind of making, like, ink wash, but with paint, with your paints.
Yeah, I mean, it's just a wash. Like, it would be, like, comparable to, like, watercolor if you put, you know. I mean, that's kind of when I paint, that's sort of how it, that's kind of how I paint. Like, it's always, like, a buildup, so I start real watery, and I just kind of, like, lay down a wash over what I'm doing, and then it's, like, I'll like, you know, if I'm going to do it with a brush, I'll just tighten that up and tighten it up, you know what I mean? Do the lights, you know, do both sides, the darks, the lights, and you just tighten and tighten. Like with an airbrush, it's the same kind of thing as a wash. You just spray over it, and then that gives it that color. You know what I mean? But it's also like what I'm spraying through the airbrush is like that watered down color. See what I mean?
Yeah. So you say you're going to do like her skin and stuff with an airbrush?
Yeah, I'll imagine I'll probably airbrush this, but you know, it just depends. It's like that Frankenstein piece, I actually painted in all of, like, I airbrushed the top, but like I painted in like all the initial tones of like the chair and everything, I painted that in. Because I wasn't quite sure about how to do it really. And so I didn't want to come in with the airbrush because I just didn't know what to spray. So I just kind of did washes. And then I was going to spray a little bit with the airbrush later, but I ended up not really using it until I started using the color pencil. Then I sprayed on it a little bit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I see, like this is a good example. Like with the drawing, like I got my drawing here too. So it's like this is all drawn. I did the same thing like with the Frankenstein. So you see how it's like the blacks and everything?
Yeah.
You can still see that, like that black around his face and stuff. That's pretty much just the underdrawing. And then it's okay. Like the toned green, which is the wash. And then the highlights are the other side of it. I mean, that's a super simple way of saying it. I went over it like several times, but it's like that's kind of the basis of like painting.
Gotcha. You know? So. Yeah, I was just curious, like, what your process was, because, like, I really like drawing on this MDF board instead of that tonal paper, because it's easier to, like, you know, you're not gumming up the paper and stuff, you don't have to worry about that. But that Khaleesi piece that I did, like, I just left it black and white Prismacolor, and then I went in and sprayed it with, like, a matte seal so it wouldn't smear, and it, like, darkened the board that I left bare for her skin, and it kind of, like... It kind of threw it off a little bit. It darkened the skin and it changed like the tonal value of the whole piece. So I wasn't sure how I was going to approach this one. If I was going to like try to go in with watercolor, what I was going to do.
Yeah, I mean you can do like that technique. I mean with any kind of, you know, like acrylic or watercolor or gouache is like another one. Gouache is really forgiving. If you don't like painting with acrylic, I would, you know, and you still want to do a water-based medium, you could do gouache. So, but yeah, I mean, like, what you're saying there is kind of the same thing. And I understand, like, yeah, like, painting or drawing on the MDF is, like, so much nicer, really, than drawing on that dang gray paper. But I like the look of that gray paper.
Yeah, me too. It seems like the MDF board that you're working on is, like, a lighter color than the kind that I can get here.
Yeah. So anyway, Mike Poxty, I guess his name is. He asked if I'm painting with acrylics, and yeah, I am painting with acrylics. And then Supergirl says Brody is right about timing. I roll my eyes anytime people airbrush the Heath Ledger Joker, same source image over and over and over. There's a lot of the Jokers out there for sure. And then Tom Hardy and Lawless was pretty good.
Like, I did like a Heath Ledger tribute piece like right after his death that was like a mashup of the Joker. Like, hold on, I'll show it to you. I think it was like 2007 or so, maybe 2008 when I did it.
Yeah.
So, like, it's not very good because it was a long time ago, but...
So Brody's getting his piece. you guys got any questions in the chat? You can throw them out. I don't know if you need to know anything or not.
I might have to do like a tutorial later on how to do this thing. I might be able to do a video of.
What the heck? Oh, hang on a sec.
Somebody actually messaged me. Yeah. What? Oh, but yeah, that'd be cool video, dude.
I guess Jay never came back.
Yeah. He's probably just busy with a client or something.
I gotta type a message super quick.
Well, there's that Joker, huh? That looks pretty cool.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't see it. I was looking at my... Yeah, that's pretty cool.
2008. So it's like really rough, and the hair is like, I had no idea how to like approach hair back then.
That's not too bad. I like it.
But that's also like during the time, like I never showed anybody like my artwork and stuff back then.
Yeah. Why not?
So I wasn't trying to sell anything or.
I think we were talking about that off air, just show people like showing artwork and stuff like that, and why you should always do it. I mean, you're always going to get better, but you know, you can wait until it's perfect to show people. You know,
it's here never you.
Cool. Got some Twilight art.
Yeah.
That's a good piece.
That was actually the next year. Like, I read, what book was it? I read, like, Lee Hammond's book on doing portraits or something, and she had, like, a great section about hair, and I got a little bit better.
Yeah. Yeah, what you were saying, though, oh, hang on a sec. Got a couple questions. Jibran asks, what do you do your underdrawing with, Jeff? Regular drawing pencils? When I do, I feel I wash away the underdrawing. So I do a sketch with like these, but usually I do that before I get on camera. And they're like these Colorace black color pencils. So they're not, you know, they're not quite graphite, but they feel kind of like graphite. But they're like kind of like this, like they're a real hard color pencil, so I can draw with it. And then like when I kind of do it and start darkening it up, I hit it with these ones, which this one's kind of shorter. Let me see here. It's these Faber-Castell black color pencils, and they're still kind of smeary, like pencil, but they're not as you know, they're not like graphite where you can just wash it right off the surface. But I know what you mean. I don't do like the thing where I put, you know, like matte medium or something over my drawings. But like if I feel like I'm getting too smeary with it, because what I try to do is just be like careful. But like if I'm getting too smeary, I'll like spray it with just like a real light coat of fixative. You know, not get it like really built up, but. That works for me. And also, like, when I hit it that first pass, you know, I use, like, it's kind of like what I was saying with the color pencil, you know, it's like a bigger brush, and it's just like that real watery acrylic, and then once it's touched with the acrylic, you know, it's down, but I know what you mean, that's kind of a problem. So Chris Kitt says, matte medium or fixative works great, steal your work. I see there's a ton of people who do that matte medium. If you're going to paint it with, like, a brush, that's probably, like, a great way to do it. But I just can't – I can't draw on that stuff once I seal it. So that's kind of out for me, but that's, like, another way to do it. So this guy, Aaron's trying to get in, and he can't get in. says he's joining my link, and then he's sitting in the chat, and there's nobody in there, which is weird. Let me resend it, if you're listening. We've had that problem with Jay a couple times, where it's like they go into a different chat room for some reason. And there's nobody in there. Might have to just figure it out after the show. You just come on next time or something. But I just sent another link if you're listening. I don't know, it's weird though. Google Hangouts, man. So Super Killer says Twilight, and he says blah. I think he really loves Twilight.
Yeah, it's not like I didn't do that piece because I was like a fan of the movies or anything. That's kind of back to what we were saying about doing pieces that you think are gonna sell.
Maybe Super Killer wants to buy it.
It's for sale. That's the original. I never sold it.
That's right.
Throwback from 2009. It's a classic.
I think Jibrin Bainley paints with like a brush, if I remember right, from just looking at your work. But like, you know, the matte medium might really work for you. The thing I hate about spraying something with fixative is that dank smell. You know, you immediately get that smell on your piece, and then it's hard to get it off, you know. And you gotta go back and work on your face right in it, you know what I mean? Can't stand that smell of that stuff. The hairspray also works. If you go get some like Aquanet hairspray, that'll like tag it down enough that you can, you know, work on top of it a little bit more. And not give it some huge, gigantic, you know, build up. I don't have the Aquanet sitting around like I used to when my mom was.
I actually used that stuff when I was younger, but it yellowed a piece of paper one time, so I stopped using it.
I can believe that. It's probably not the best. On like a finished piece, I probably wouldn't use it, but you know, just to like stick your drawing down so that you can paint over it, probably work there.
Yeah.
I look at it when you're like painting, everything gets sealed in there anyway, so it's sort of like... Okay, so Aaron Young messaged me again. I'm gonna say it on the camera, but yeah, we'll just after the show, I'll try to get you in here and we'll try to figure it out. So I don't know what's going on with the hangout. Then Timothy Phillips says he needs some Pitch Perfect fan art. And then in Airbrush, we have a product called AG2050 that's water-based, so it doesn't stain. Super Killer said that. I never heard of that stuff.
Perfect.
Then Lindro says, my little niece loves Twilight. It's understandable that movie was made for that target of teenage females. Yeah, there's a lot of Twilight fans out there. I mean, we might all bust on it, but there's a lot of Twilight fans out there.
Yeah, wait, you're back. Yeah.
What?
It's gone.
Look.
And Lindra says, I wonder if there's any feminists watching that complain about the Black Widow being too sexist. I don't think so, maybe.
Did you do a lot of... There's a lot of articles about how Mad Max was like a huge feminist film, but it's,
really?
If that's the case, give me more of them because it was fucking awesome.
Yeah.
Well, I guess because like the focus really wasn't on I mean Mad Max, yeah, he's the title character, but it was like so much focus on Charlize Theron as Imperator Furiosa that she was like the main character of the film, I think. Like, the whole storyline was based around her action, so... I don't know. Maybe that's why they say that, but it was... Yeah, you're gonna have to watch it, man. It's good.
Yeah, I intend to.
I talk so much about it that you'll probably come back and be like, yeah, I really didn't like it that much.
I probably will.
I mean, I love, you know, Road Warrior and all that, so if it's got that kind of feel, I'm sure I'll be into it. Yeah, I don't know. I've seen, like, some people, like, say, like, you know, like, the first Alien, like, feminist. I don't know. To me, it's just a good movie. It doesn't matter to me, one way or the other.
Yeah.
I like the female heroine type,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah, me too. They're coming out with another Alien. They're supposed to have Sigourney Weaver in the movie role again.
Oh, my God. Just let it die.
Well, so apparently it's supposed to, like, not have anything to do with, like, Prometheus. It's supposed to be, like, immediately after the last actual Alien film that had her in it.
Well, let's see. What was the last one? That wasn't the one where she was on the prison planet, was it?
I think that's where she was, like, a cyborg or something, wasn't she?
Hmm. Yeah, could be good. I don't know.
Or she was a clone. She was a clone or something.
Yeah. That's hard to say. But really, I mean, that Terminator one's the one that I'm just like, I don't know what. I gotta see that and see what they're doing there.
Yeah.
I don't know. Because I love that first Terminator movie, like, so much. To me, it's just like, if they go back and, like, start rewriting the history like George Lucas did with the Star Wars stuff, I don't know if I'm going to dig it. You know? Going to be annoying. Yeah,
I just wish that they would take all of this creative energy that they're making all these reboots and, like, sequels to and create new properties.
That'd be cool.
The reason I love the new Mad Max so much is because it was like a throwback to all those movies I loved growing up, like the original Mad Max and all those action films. You know, I love those horror movies back then. I love the action movies. Pumpkinhead, Big Trouble in Little China, Mad Max, Blade Runner. It's like I wish they would take, you know, the stuff that people love and create new properties that, you know, are based around the same kind of thing, but it's like they don't. All these people working in Hollywood, all they're doing is like making the same movies they made 30 years ago.
Well, there's new stuff too. But yeah, I mean, there's a lot of remake stuff. But there's always been a lot of remake stuff. That's always been going on. Yeah. You know? I mean, they used to, like, get back in the 80s, man. They were, like, so bad with the sequels. The sequels always sucked, and they just, like, pump them out as fast as they could and just kill it, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And the sequels were always just, like, you know, like, not even like they'd write a new story, it'd just be almost like a remake of the same one, you know? I don't know.
Or they'd have movies that would be, like, I don't know, like, The Howling movies, for example. They'd have, like, The Howling 2, The Howling 3, and they would have no connection to the previous one.
Right. Yeah. I mean, I think, like, the first time, like, I guess Mad Max, that was, like, a sequel that was, you know, that was, like, a good sequel. And then, like, Terminator 2, they did a good sequel there. But, I mean, God, there was just so many of those movies where they do the sequel, it'd be so sucky.
Yeah.
Yeah. Be so shitty.
Yeah, it's hit or miss, you know.
Yeah. It's like the Superman movies. This is like the sequels just got worse and worse. I don't know. Yeah, I wish they'd, I don't know, I like when, you know, they do new, I don't know, I guess that's just the thing, is there's so much, you know, there's so much money to be made, I guess, from, like, going back to, like, you know, hitting that nostalgia button over and over again for people. It's kind of like the superhero stuff, you know?
Mm-hmm. But. Yeah, it's, I don't know, like, they have come out with some new stuff, but it really hasn't interested me as much, I guess.
Yeah. Well, I was thinking like that. Pacific Rim.
Yeah, I didn't really like that much. And like the Godzilla, like the remake of Godzilla, like that wasn't, I mean, I know that's a remake, but that wasn't, I didn't really enjoy that either.
Nah. I don't know, the Godzilla movies, it's like, it's just, I don't want to get them, but just, they were kind of bad movies in the first place, you know?
Uh-huh. But, yeah.
Somebody had me do a couple Godzilla. That was one that, like, that I kind of got on for a while. Like this, I did this one Godzilla sketch card, and then it was just like I kept getting like these Godzilla commissions over and over, and I was just like, ah, Godzilla again, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But it's like I went and I was just kind of trying to find like decent reference and different reference and stuff like that. And God, there's so many Godzilla movies they made I didn't even know about, you know. A ton of those things.
Yeah, all the Godzilla versus movies.
Yeah. A ton of them.
Like the Godzilla versus Gengar.
Oh, let's see. Oh, that it was Alien Resurrection. That's right. That's what that movie was called. Lindro put it in the chat.
Yeah, that was actually what's his name? Joss Whedon did that one. But I didn't really like that one.
Yeah. And Femox, he says, who's even playing Mad Max? I've heard good things about the movie. Yeah, you missed out, dude. We talked about Mad Max through the whole front of the show. So yeah.
Tom Hardy is playing Mad Max. Bane. It is Bane.
Brody says it's good, so it's giving it a thumbs up. So Scott, right?
Yep.
Yeah, I want to see it. I don't know. I also, you know, you mentioned that other show. I want to watch that also. I heard some good stuff. It's that American Crime. What's that one with Matthew McConaughey? Did you mention?
Oh, True Detective.
True Detective. That's right. I watched one of those. It was really good. I want to watch like the rest of it now.
Well, like, they're getting ready to come out with season two, and season two is like Vince Vaughn and Colin Farrell.
Yeah.
They're like the new detectives, and I guess I don't know. It's supposed to be pretty good.
Is it pretty cool?
Yeah, I really enjoyed the first season with like Matthew McConaughey and
Woody
Harrelson. Yeah.
That looks good. I guess that came out a while ago.
Yeah, it was last year. Like, beginning of last year, I think.
Yeah.
I thought it was, I can probably find it online somewhere. Like, I found that other movie for you. I'll send it to you if I see it.
Okay. Thanks, man. What movie was that you found for me? Was that The Gray or whatever?
No, the Yeah,
oh, that,
I think it was Valhalla Rising. Did you ever finish that?
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
It was different. It was like an artsy Viking movie, you know?
Yeah.
Have you ever seen Pathfinder with Carl Urban?
Yeah, I went to see that one at the theater. I didn't really dig that one, though.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I don't know. It seemed kind of corny.
There's another movie where it was like, what the hell was it called? It was kind of the same kind of thing, except it was like, it was tribal, and I don't even remember the name of it. I can't think of it.
Yeah, I love the, like, the look of it, you know? And I like the whole idea of it, like the Indians and the Vikings. I was like, hell yeah. But I just, you know, like when I actually watched it, I was just, I didn't dig it. But that was also, like, I remember Pathfinder came out, and then I think 300 came out right around that same time. I remember going to see that, and I was just like, to me, like 300 just like so killed it, and then Pathfinder just wasn't there. So.
I never watched the second 100.
Yeah, I didn't like it. I really didn't like it.
So a lot of people have said that about it.
Yeah, you'd think it would have been like so much better, like because of the first one, but I just did not dig it. Yeah, I like all that stuff.
Hey guys, I gotta go. I gotta help get my son get ready for graduation and everything.
Okay, have fun.
All right. I don't know if I probably won't be here tomorrow either, but I'll try to get Thursday or so.
Yeah, I'll see you sometime. I'll send you
later.
See ya.
Yeah, Super Killer said Pathfinder had great Viking costumes. Yeah, that was totally why I went to see it. I was just like, man, this movie looks like Death Dealer or something.
I remember that other one. It was Apocalyptica. Have you ever seen that?
Yeah, that was pretty good.
Yeah.
I like that one. The Mel Gibson.
Was he the director?
Know. Yeah, he directed that. I mean, I guess I like that one just because it's like the look of it too, you know, it's like, and plus I'm into Westerns, which I know that's not a Western, but it did have Indians in it. And you never see like anything like that, like all the South American, you know, Aztecs and all that. So I thought that was really cool just to see like all that stuff. So. Yeah, I know. Too bad Mel Gibson had turned out to be such a wacko. He's got so many good movies. Yeah. Such a wife beater.
Yeah. It's a shame.
It is.
It well, at first they said that he was going to have like a cameo in this new Mad Max, and then they said he wasn't going to.
Really? I'm surprised they didn't get him in there somewhere, but I don't know. I remember I painted a rare Road Warrior card, you know, like sketch card. Back when all that shit was happening with like his wife, his ex-wife's and stuff.
Yeah.
And I just wasn't paying attention to like any of it, you know. And like I put that card out there. Man, I could not sell that thing for like the life of me, you know. Everybody just hated him, you know.
So you should have done some Charlie Sheen cards.
Yeah, I know. They probably would have went over too.
Those probably would have sold. Everybody was all about that crazy crap.
I know. I almost think the Charlie Sheen ones might have, you know. I don't think people just thought he was crazy. Like you know, whatever. Mel Gibson, he was just like, you know. Some of those, like, yeah, those are just bad, but I don't know. Did you see, like, I don't like this show at all, but that 2.5 Men, like the season finale of that show.
No, actually, I seen a bunch of episodes when he was still playing in it, but I never seen like the ending, like when he was not in it anymore, and I never saw it when Ashton Kutcher took over.
I don't like that Ashton Kutcher on that show, even though like I said, I don't really like that show anyway. But yeah, I don't know. It's like one of those shows like I don't like, but then I find myself watching it. You know,
yeah,
it is funny sometimes, especially like the ones with like Charlie Sheen on it. But yeah, like I don't like the Ashton Kutcher.
It's so funny. Yeah. Like everybody was pissed off that he was coming to work like drunk and stuff or on drugs. And I'm like, well, you pretty much made a show about his life. So what do you expect him to do?
Right. It's like it's almost like his character on the show.
Yeah, but, he's like playing himself. What do you want from him?
Yeah. But he, like in the season, the finale. I mean, it was like the most bizarre, like. I mean, just weird. I mean, I thought they were going to, like, bring him back, and then, like, but they don't actually have Charlie Sheen on it. He's, like, they have, like, a animated, like, claymation version of him. And it was just the weirdest. Yeah, it just made no sense. Like, the whole thing was just, like, I don't know.
That sounds really weird.
Bring him back in. He was, like, supposed to be. Like, it turns out, like, he wasn't dead, and he's, like, trapped somewhere or something.
What the hell?
It was just weird. Yeah, like, Yeah, the animated part was like him, you know, getting away. So you like think it's like, oh, okay, he's gonna get away, and then like he's gonna show up on the show, but then it never happened. You're just like, what? And then the show just ends. I don't know.
Wow.
I'm not much into those like sitcoms anyway. Some of them I like, but
I don't really watch any of those anymore. Like they're just not funny to me. I watch Modern Family a little bit because it had you know, the guy that played Al from Married with Children.
Yeah.
I can still watch Married with Children episodes too. Like, that was a good show. It's funny. I still find it humorous, you know. I think it's a lot funnier than a lot of the stuff they put on TV now.
Man, that Married with Children was like funny, man. I used to love that show.
Yeah, he's like play on. His wife or whatever, she would find like a peanut or like a M&M, and she's like, "Don't tell Dad, it's the only one." Because they didn't have any food.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of funny ones. They still replay those on TV, I noticed.
Yeah, it was funny. But yeah, he plays in that Modern Family show. And
yeah, I see. I've
seen a few episodes. It's funny.
Yeah. I have a hard time liking that show, though.
Oh, really?
I don't know. It just seems so dumb sometimes. What's that one? There's like that one that's after it too that just drives me crazy.
I can't remember
it now. The only one that I've seen that I really think is hilarious, like kind of in that vein. Oh, now I can't remember the name of it. I'm never going to remember now. But there's like one about the family. Well, it's like a family. It's on right around that same time that one show's on. And it's like they're a family. They're kind of like in the 80s or 70s or something. The Goldbergs, that's what it's called. Have you ever watched that one?
No, I've actually never heard of it. The Goldbergs?
Yeah. Is it just called The Goldbergs, or it's called Welcome to the Goldbergs or something? Well, that one is actually funny, and I thought I was going to like hate it when I first saw it, but it's actually pretty hilarious. If you ever get a chance to watch it, I guess.
I'll have to look into it.
Then they got like that other one I was watching. I guess it's just on sometime when I'm in front of the TV, but it's like the new Odd Couple or whatever. Have you seen that?
Mm-mm.
With the guy out, like the one guy is like the guy off of Friends. He's plays like Oscar or whatever. And it's just like the old like Odd Couple. It's like got the same feel and everything.
No, I haven't seen that one either.
It's kind of funny. I don't know. It wasn't killing me funny, but. And then there's like this other one I watch, and it's just, I know it's on after, I can't remember what it's after, but it's after like some show I watch. So it's like, I always seem to watch it, even though it's like, I don't like it, but it is kind of funny though. It's like that New Girl. You ever watch that one?
Oh yeah. With Zooey Deschanel or something.
Right.
Yeah. I just think she's hot anyway.
She's hot.
She's like nerdy hot, I think.
Yeah, it's like one of those shows where it's like, yeah, as soon as it comes on, I'm like, oh god, and then but I end up sitting there watching the whole thing, and you know, it's actually kind of funny. I don't know, guilty pleasure, I guess. All those shows are like just shows I watch with my wife, you know, like while we're eating dinner. So I just figure there's nothing good on ever. So
I was watching that show The Following, but they just had like the season finale yesterday, and I found out it got canceled. Like, they're not bringing it back.
Is that the one with the Kevin Bacon or whatever?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I was watching a little bit of that, but Tristan was up, so it was getting a little too violent. Yeah. So
it's turned too violent.
It looked pretty good. I hadn't seen any of them up till then, so it's gone now, though.
Yeah, it's like Fox, man. They have a bad habit of like canceling shows that are actually really good. Yeah. I guess they have all these numbers that they want to meet. They're probably really, you know, it's outrageous, and they don't meet them, so they cancel the show.
Yeah, I hate that. Yeah, I don't know. Those ones, like, I mean, I like comedies, like, when they're funny, but there's just so many comedies that are just so sucky anymore, you know? And then the other ones, like, I just, like, another guilty pleasure is all these, like, the cooking shows, like Hell's Kitchen, Kitchen Nightmares and stuff.
Whatever.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like some of those shows. Like, I was watching, it came on Spike, the Spike channel, but it was called Bar Rescue, where, like, this guy, John would go in and, like, these bars would be, like, failing and, like, in debt, and he would, like, revamp them.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's interesting. I guess I'm just really entertained by people being assholes to other people. I guess I don't know.
I don't know. I don't like that. I actually hate that, but it's like, yeah, it's, I don't know why I like watching the... I think it's because it's like people get voted off, so I always want to see who wins it, you know?
Right.
So, but yeah, because when I first started watching the Gordon Ramsay ones, I was like, ah, this guy's a dick. I can't watch this, but now I'm kind of hooked on him.
Have you ever seen like the... It was like a comedy video where he's like a kid.
Yeah,
and, his mom makes his lunch or something, and he like, gives off him.
Right, that's hilarious. They've got like a bunch of those. They got like one where he goes to like a restaurant too, and the parents are just like hiding themselves because they're just he's like embarrassing him so much. Yeah, those are funny. Wonder who that kid is.
Yeah, I don't know.
They should have him on the show. I don't know. Hey, Kevin jumped in.
Hey, what's up? Did I miss the show?
We're actually still live, so...
Breakfast?
Yeah.
I know. Now we'll go for a while longer if you guys want to.
Yeah, it's
We're
fun.
We're talking about crappy reality TV.
Yeah, I heard you talking about Gordon Ramsay. Got pretty addicted.
Yeah. It's easy. It's easy to do.
Yeah. And, you know, it was something like I kind of fought. I was like, God, he's such a prick.
Yeah.
And then I was like, and after a while, I was like, no, he's just giving tough love. He's very passionate. He cares so much. He wants the best from everybody.
Yeah.
You're just not delicate.
Yeah. You're ruining the scallops. Yeah.
There's a good drink.
It's almost like the same shit. Yeah. Totally. How many times I ruin that? Whatever that rice is. It's like that. That's one I always fuck up. Nobody can seem to get right. That rice. What do they call that stuff?
Oh,
not paella, it's something else.
Risotto.
Risotto, that's right. Fucking risotto. It's always the death of somebody on that show.
Yeah, the drinking game, though, is every time he says yeah or yes, because, you know, he says, like, you don't want scalps to be rubbery, yeah? You don't want this, you fucked up, yes?
That's totally true. Totally true. I noticed, like, on this last season, like, you know how they have, like, the guest chefs come in and they, like, you know, they cook something for them and, you know, they judge them or whatever. And then on one of the shows, they had, like, it's like, here's the guest chefs, and then, like, one of the guest chefs, and I guess he's not a chef, he's just the guest judge, was the, he's like the mailman off of Cheers. Remember that guy, Cliff?
Yeah.
I'm like, how does this guy get in here? Yeah. Can't remember his real name either, but so how does that work?
I haven't watched that one yet. I kind of just catch it like when it goes to Netflix or something like that.
Yeah.
So I guess I'm behind on his different series, but. There was that one series where, you know, he's going to the restaurants and, like,
yeah.
The menus and stuff.
Yeah.
It's, like, now where when we go out to eat anywhere, And there's a menu that has over, like, six things. My wife and I, we just look at each other and we're like, man, Gordon Ramsay would hate it here.
I know. I know.
What's that one? Is that one called... That's like Kitchen Nightmares or something, isn't it?
Yeah.
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 I guess that was the first one. That's the one I really, like, got addicted to.
Yeah.
The American version I don't like as much because you really need him to cuss, I think.
They've got, like, an ink... I guess I've only seen the American version. There's, like, what, like, over in, like, the UK he's doing that or something?
That's where he started, yeah.
Yeah. And it was, okay. Oh, God, there's a phrase that he said all the time on the UK one that he doesn't say on the US one. What is it? I mean, he said fuck every other word.
Yeah.
But... it'll come to me. It was so funny. I was saying it for a while because it was so funny.
Yeah.
But.
Yeah, he is pretty funny.
Yeah, and other than that, the only other reality show that I got into was that webcomics one that.
Yeah.
Lasted that one season.
Penny Arcade Guys.
Yeah.
I totally, like, yeah, I was all into that. I was hoping they would do more of those.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess maybe because it was just like an internet-only thing. I don't know, but they're so popular that, you know.
Yeah, you think they could get that on some shitty like cable channel or something, you know?
Yeah, I totally thought there would be more. I don't know. No one cares about art on regular people. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was a pretty entertaining show.
Definitely. And that got me, like, the girl who won that, you know? Like, she's got, like, a pretty good webcomic.
Yeah, you know, I looked at the, you know, they ended with, you know, you're going to get studio space or office, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I looked at the website that they built for her on that webcomic, and, she stopped doing it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
It's like all the pages that she had done for it on the show.
Yeah, oh, right.
Like, we saw, like, some of the black and white ones, and they ended up in color, and she just colored them and stopped.
Wow.
Oh, man. You know, it's funny, because I remember, like, the comic she did on the show. That's not actually the comic. Like, I thought, I don't know if she's still doing the one she does, but it's... I think it's called, like, Scala, you know, it's like this, you know, Red Sonja type chick.
Oh, yeah, this is different, because the one she did on the show was, like, a summer camp.
Yeah.
Kind of thing.
But that's funny, I've kind of forgot that, like, that was the one she was doing on the show. Yeah, so that didn't go on, though.
No.
That's funny. She probably went down there and started working with those guys, and she's like, I can't stand you people. Get out of here.
I get the impression that the Penny Arcade guys are kind of dicks.
Right. I thought they were pretty funny, though, on the show, like, you know, the way they would, because they do the thing like Gordon Ramsay, like, where they judge you at the end, and,
yeah,
like, you know, like that one, I don't remember, like, I remember them putting, like, one guy's art in, like, a blender and, like, drinking it or something. Yeah. But then, like, after, like, when they're all dejected in the limo, like, on The Bachelorette, when they're, like, crying or something, it's like they jump in the limo and they're like, hey, man, you're going to make it. You're going to be okay. I thought that was kind of cool. I don't know. Have you ever seen any of those, Brody?
No, I haven't. You guys are making me want to find them.
It's pretty good. I think it's called, now I can't even think. Stripped is in the title, but... I was going to say Strip, but that's a documentary about comic strip artists.
Is it called Strip Search?
Strip Search, maybe.
Yeah.
That sounds right.
It's either, like, Strip or Strip Search. Yeah, it's on YouTube. If you, like, search, like, that and, like, Penny Arcade, I'm sure you'll find it. Because it's, like, the Penny Arcade guys who put it on.
Yeah, I'll look it up later on today.
Yeah. You guys should do that for the 100 is the comics thing.
I think you should do that for the R-casters, start picking people off.
She's been talking about it. Yeah, it's called strip search.
Strip okay. Search.
Super Killer says Bar Rescue is addicting.
Never seen Bar Rescue.
Yes. Yeah, it's pretty good. They have a couple episodes on like their YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Yeah, I didn't see that. I saw the one where he went in and like saved hotels.
if you like Kitchen Nightmares, then you'll like Bar Rescue because he cusses a lot on that show.
Is Gordon Ramsay on that one too?
No, this guy's name is John Taffer. He's like a bartender who owns bars, so he like specifically goes in and like saves bars and like revamps like their kitchen menu.
Oh, you know what? I do know about this show. I just haven't seen it. There is a bar in town here that they bar rescued, and everyone in town hates it.
Oh, they still hate it.
Yeah, it's this place that a lot of bands play, a lot of punk and metal bands play in town here.
Yeah, they probably came in and, like, wrecked it, right? They got rid of, like, the crappy food that probably everybody liked.
Yeah.
The kitchen, yeah.
Yeah.
It's just not the same anymore.
Totally.
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out how they're losing money then. Like, if this guy's supposed to come in and, like, change the menu so these people make money and then it pisses people off, well, the people that's pissing off obviously like the place already. So what's the problem?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
A place called the Tonic Room, or not Tonic Room, sorry, Tonic Lounge here. And, people liked it, and then they changed the sign. It says the Panic Room on the outside now. And like what he tried to do was, like, or what they tried to do, whatever, is they tried to make it even more metal and more punk, but coming from like an outsider's view of those genres instead of an insider. Like, maybe he does like metal or something like that, but
yeah,
you know, maybe he likes like, you know, I don't know, kind of mall metal, like more like a Limp Bizkit type thing instead of a Slayer where, you know, like a Slayer, like people love here, but Limp Bizkit people hate here, you know, so. So, but it feels like that. It feels very 90s on the outside.
Yeah.
And people are like, what is this? This guy does not get it. But the owners went with it, I guess. And from one of the local papers, they're slowly changing the menu back.
Yeah.
And then shortly after, they closed their doors. No.
Maybe. Well, I wonder, like, if just him going, like, not the bar guy, but, like, Gordon Ramsay going to, like, these places, if it just, you know, gives them enough press to kind of bring them back, you know what I mean?
Right.
Just having them on the show and stuff, you know, it's got to, you know, you think people around there would, like, go, oh, hey, there's that restaurant, you know, maybe let's go eat there, see what it's like now, you know?
Yeah.
Well, I'm surprised it's not in the contracts where they're like, well, if we do this revamp, then you have to leave, like, you're not allowed to change anything for X amount of time.
Right. Well, that one guy did, though. I remember on one of those Kitchen Nightmares, it was like he changed everything, and then the guy just immediately started, like, throwing it all out and, like, went back and pulled all his, you know, junk out of the dumpster and was, like, bringing his old chairs and shit back in.
like, my lucky chair.
Like, in some of that early Gordon Ramsay stuff, Kitchen Nightmares and stuff, you know, he'd go back and like revisit. And then I noticed like in the later different series that they're, you know, that are like that or that he did, he wouldn't go back and visit.
Yeah. I did see, they've showed some of the ones where he goes back and revisits and like most of them are, you know, like doing better and like sometimes they'll be like out of business and stuff.
Yeah.
It's pretty wild. He's all cool when he comes in this time. The first time he comes in there and he, like, takes one bite of the fish and he, like, spits it out in disgust. And then it's like, you know, he's, like, having lunch. It's like having lunch with him, like in the new one, and he's like, "Oh yeah, it's good, it's good." I'm just like, no, he's probably lying.
Yeah, the camera cuts and he spits it out.
That's funny.
Y'all didn't learn a bloody fucking thing since the last time I was here.
Right. Really. He spits it out. He's like, oh, it's on now. Get in that kitchen. We're going to redo it again. That's funny. I always wonder, like, you know, like on Hell's Kitchen, when he picks, like, the head chef or wherever, like his hotel in, you know, Las Vegas or something. Like, you know, he's got, like, all these people that, like, probably work there would already be, like, more qualified to be, like, the head chef. And then he's, like, picking this, like, you know, young rookie kid.
Yeah, it's always the new chef.
I know. It's just, like, how does that work, you know? Is he just kind of like a figurehead chef? Like, you know, like he's, like, the president but doesn't actually get to do anything to mess things up?
We're going to say you're the chef on TV, but we're really not going to let you do anything when you get there.
Right.
Yeah, there's one where he got this, like, real young girl, like, she was 20 or something, you know?
Man.
And he made her the head chef because he was like, she's way more imaginative than you, and talking to the guy who was the head chef, and
yeah,
they had some big fight, and, you know, I don't know, and the girl cried, oh, you're making me my career, and
yeah.
I know.
That's like the ones that always get me too. Like when he goes to like, because he always goes to like, you know, all kinds of restaurants. But it's like when he goes to like the dive diner, like in Nevada somewhere. Uh-huh. And the guy who's like working the kitchen is like this biker dude that like smokes while he cooks and shit. I always feel so bad for that guy, you know, because it's just like, you know, he's like, where's your passion? He's like passion for like, you know. I don't know. Do I really have to have that much passion to like flip burgers here, you know?
Right. Where's your passion for the food? He's like, listen, brother.
Right. Yeah.
Like, I'm just saving up to get to Sturgis.
That's right. Yeah. Then they go, you know, those guys always end up getting fired, so I figure like, oh, that poor guy. He's gotta go find some other shitty job. Thanks, Gordon Ramsay. I don't know. So actually, Bumpy Knuckle says, two places in town here have been on Kitchen Nightmares, and it both closed a year later. That's weird.
Yeah, I mean, that makes sense, though. You know, it's like, because they go... going to town, you know, fix these bars or whatever, because it's good TV, but, you know, they don't care how far it goes after that.
Right.
The show's done.
Well, too, like, when they come in, a lot of those places are, like, freaking $100,000 or $1 million in debt. Like, just because Gordon Ramsay comes in doesn't mean he's going to be in debt, you know?
Yeah, because, I mean, to make
it not good, before the bank takes it, you know?
Right. Make any business work, you know, it's, I mean, the standard is, like, you know, 3 years or something.
Yeah.
So if they're, like, that far in debt and they're trying to revamp their business, it's almost like starting over, it seems like.
So yeah.
Not going to change overnight, and I think some of these people think that it is.
So yeah.
It's all a false hope, in a way. Like, this Panic Room place that I'm talking about that they changed with the bar show in town, I guess, like, a lot of the paint and stuff is chipping and falling away, and
yeah,
they just use cheap stuff.
Oh, well, yeah, that's another thing, you know, being like a painter and stuff. I've always wondered, because like they go in and like when they revamp the whole place, it's like they do in one fucking night, you know?
Yeah.
And you're always like, how do they even get like, how do they tile things in like one night? How do they like even get the trim to dry and then paint the walls? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I was wondering that too.
How many people could they shove in this little space to do this? It just seems impossible, you know?
Yeah.
All just like movie props. Hey, this fucking counter's made out of cardboard, goddammit.
Yeah. They just wheel in like a big piece of plywood that's been like airbrushed with the background and they stick it to the wall.
Yeah. Totally.
Well, somebody in the chat asked you, are you in, were you, where was it now? Oh, it says, one thing, another one just jumped in and I missed it.
Oh, was the Boons Brigade? Kevin.
Yeah, that thing.
Can you see it? Yeah, I see it. Kevin, were you into the Boons Brigade in the day?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, that was for, I don't know if you know what that is, Jeff, do you?
No, I sure don't.
You know who Tony Hawk is, right?
What was it?
You know who Tony Hawk is, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah, like the skateboarder guy?
Yeah, so Boons Brigade was a skate team, bunch of pro skaters on Hal Peralta, sponsored by them, and back in the 80s, it was like their kind of prominence. I guess they went into the 90s a bit, too. But, yeah, they were like one of the big teams growing up. So I was really into, like, Boons Brigade, and I was into the Santa Cruz team a lot, and I was into the Schmidt Sticks team a lot, which is kind of funny because I never rode Schmidt Sticks boards. And I was really into Alva because they were like the tough punkers. So.
But yeah, Tim said there's a great documentary on Netflix. I don't know if it's the same one, but I watched one with Tas Pappas in it. You remember him?
Tas Pappas?
Yeah, he was the one that basically he invented the 920 or whatever that Tony Hawk took and did at the X Games.
Huh. When you say Tas Pappas, all I can think of is not as Kappas.
Tas Pappas, he had a brother, and his brother ended up, I think his brother killed himself, but they were both skateboard artists, and they came to the States and ended up getting deported back to Australia.
Oh, man, I don't remember, I don't know.
But, yeah, like, he used to get in the X Games, and, like, he kept trying to do the 920, he created the 920 or whatever, and the X Games that he was at, they let Tony Hawk go before him, or they wouldn't let him compete in the, like, you know how at the end of the X Games, they always had, like, the contest, the trick contest or whatever? They wouldn't let him compete in it, and then they let Tony Hawk, and Tony Hawk did his 920, and that's how Tony Hawk got, like, basically, he was saying that Tony Hawk stole his 920 and that the X Games was in it with Tony Hawk, and it's actually a really good documentary. And that guy, like, he went through a hell of a lot of stuff. Like, he got deported because they found cocaine in his shoe. It was, like, duct taped under the sole of his skateboarding shoe. And then they also, in a skateboard, like, they ripped the duct tape off and he had, like, cocaine packed in his deck or whatever.
Well, see, that's when pro skateboarding was doing good.
Yeah. But anyway, like, it's a really good documentary, and it was on Netflix. I forget what it was called, but I actually talked to him a few times through, like, social media, and he's, like, a super nice guy.
And it's not the it's not the Boons Brigade documentary, right?
I think they mentioned the Boons Brigade in there, but I don't think it's the same.
No, well, because you can watch the Boons Brigade documentary on Netflix too. But so is the are these brothers? Are they twins?
I think they were twins.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about. I haven't watched the documentary yet, but. Yeah, I did see that. It's in my queue. For sure. Now we're talking about it, I'll probably watch it tonight.
Yeah, it's good. I thought it was really good. It's sad, man. It's, like, sad to see how, like, they came up from nothing and, like, made something of themselves through skating and, like, all the shit that happened to them.
It happened to a lot of people back then. Like, I mean, you know, I'm sure you've seen the Gator documentary.
Yeah.
Which is super disappointing because, like, what happened to him. Because I was a huge fan of Gator back in the day.
Well, so the whole industry, man, and it's like it changed. Like, especially, like, they were talking about how X Games, like, started focusing on profits and didn't care about the sport.
Fuck the X Games. Nothing fucking boring or punk rock about that fucking thing. There you go. That's my soapbox. I mean, I can go on some box with it. I hate the X Games. I hate the band's Warped Tour. I hate the X Games. They took all the soul out of skateboarding and punk rock.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like, that's what you kind of realize that when you watch all these documentaries.
Yeah, well, it's like, so like Hosoi, you know, he had his bout with drugs, and you know, he got busted like running meth into Hawaii and all this kind of stuff. Gator turned into a murderer. Jeff Phillips got super depressed and killed himself. And you know, you hear all these stories because, and here's my take on it is that what happens is you get these young people. And then they become celebrities, you know, and they go nuts.
Yeah, see, we were talking about that yesterday. You should have been on yesterday's show. We were talking about all, like, the childhood stars, like, grew up and, like, you know, died from drug overdoses or, like, suicides.
Yeah, because it's just not a normal thing to do. You know, it's just not a normal life, and it's not, like, you're growing up in public, and, you know, a lot of pro skaters go pro when they're teenagers. And so... You know, just, I don't know, some people just can't handle it, and it goes to their head, and then, you know, you're so young that you think that that's real life, you know, and it's not, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, if that's, like, your normal, and then, like, when the real normal shows up, it's like, that's a drag, you know what I mean?
Yeah, like, totally. But, and then, on the flip side of that, you find the other guys who, like, so I grew up in the Bay Area, so there's a lot of pro skaters there. And some, like, were friends that became pro and stuff like that. And I used to work at Deluxe, which is, I was in the art room there, which is, like, Spitfire wheels, real skateboards, Anti-Hero.
Okay.
And stuff. And I got hired because I'm buddies with... Jim Thiebaud, who is one of the kind of less popular Bones Brigade guys. But he did, like, what a lot of, like, the ones who don't go nuts do. They start their own companies, you know? So, it's not all bad, but...
Yeah. That's pretty interesting.
Like, do you know Zero Skateboards?
Yeah.
I was talking to Jamie Thomas. He was going to hire me, but he wanted me to move to Vista, California, which would have been nice because, in retrospect, because it would have kept me in California. But it's Vista, California. If you know that place, it's the butthole suburb.
Yeah, those are the guys that I grew up loving. Like when I was growing up and skating, like Jamie Thomas, Danny Way, Bucky Lassick, all those guys. You know?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, those guys were still. You know, those are my guys too, but they were like amateur more or less, but they were still showing up. You know, I mean, like,
right?
Danny Way and Bucky Lassick are in like Search for Animal Chin, but they're like little kids. You know?
Dude, I remember when Danny Way jumped out of that helicopter on the vert ramp when I was like, in I think it was like 8th or 9th grade. They had a big like article in Skateboarding Magazine about it.
Yeah, see, just by hearing you say that, I can tell our age difference. Because I remember that was. Older. There's that, I don't know if it's still on Netflix, but there's a documentary about Danny Way, like, jumping over the Great Wall of China and stuff.
Oh, really?
Yeah, have you seen that?
No, I didn't even know it was on there. I wonder if it still is.
Yeah, I can't remember what it's called, but, you know, if you just search Danny Way, it'll show up. It's still there.
And he jumped over the Great Wall of China?
Yeah, so they built two ramps, you know, on either side of the Great Wall of China, and it's gnarly.
First off, I'm surprised they even let him do it.
Yeah, and he, like, just fucking blasts an air over the Great Wall of China. It's fucking gnarly.
Cool.
Like, skateboarding, since I was a kid, you know, I mean, like, I'm an, you know, 80s teenager, so, you know, it was all punk rock and... You know, getting like we were that's when skateboarders were considered juvenile delinquents and stuff because I don't really know why, but
they still are a lot of places.
Kinda, except for now you go to skate parks and it's all cutesy kids and they like want to know what tricks you can do. And back in the day, no one cared what tricks you could do; they just cared that you cared about skateboarding. You know,
well, like for the longest time, like they just actually started building skate parks here like maybe 5 years ago. And they would never let us skate anywhere. You know, they'd be like, oh, you know, it's loitering, and you can't skate here. And there'd be signs everywhere, and they'd call the cops on you. And then you would try to fundraise a skate park, and then the town or the county would shut it down. And I'm like, well, you're going to bitch about us riding on sidewalks and around businesses, but you're not giving us a place to skate.
Yeah, that's how it was growing up in San Francisco. It was like that. We used to get tickets, and sometimes your board would get taken.
There was
a point where there's even skate shops in town that give you a discount. Like, if you bring your ticket in, and you got, like a really good discount. You know, it wasn't just, like, some, like, little, like, 10% off. It was, like, a nice discount. Because the skateboarding, it was, like, such a community back then, you know? It was a lot smaller because, you know, it had its boom period in the 60s and 70s, and then, you know, in the 80s, it was, like, maybe that's why it was considered for delinquents, because it was just like punk rockers doing it. But yeah, you got this big discount, and yeah, they were really shitty back then. But yeah, now it's all skate parks going in everywhere, which I like. I think it's really nice, but on the one hand, I don't, because probably just because I'm old. And I remember, like, we had to, like, find stuff ourselves, and, you know,
yeah.
We skated, you know, it's that whole, like, we skated uphill in the snow. Just the
about you, Jeff, you ever skate?
No.
Start, dude.
Start? No, I don't think
so. Yeah, good. We're not that, you know, you're barely older than me, like, a year or two.
Yeah, but.
Yeah. Our bones still are, you know.
It's a whole different world. I wouldn't even know where to.
Yeah, I mean, I still skate, but not nearly like I used to, you know. Like,
yeah.
The amount of tricks I do now is way smaller.
I actually considered trading in my just my regular vert board for a long board, just get it.
I'm coming to your house right now. Don't tell me that. Don't do it, man. You'll regret it. I swear.
Really?
Yeah. If you want another board, get another board. Don't trade in a board.
Don't get rid of the one I have.
You'll regret it, man, because in 2 years from now, you'll be like, oh, shit, I wish I still had that, and you'll be buying another one.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if you skate enough, you're going to have to buy another one anyway because you're going to break it. But but you know what I'm saying.
I remember the last time I broke a board, I tried to do it. This is when I was learning how to kickflip. I spent so much time learning how to kickflip, and it's like, nah, I don't even. It's been so. Like, I don't even know how to do it anymore.
I can still do it, but, like, you know, I used to, like, do big stairs and stuff like that, and now I'm like, you know, I don't know. My bones hurt more than they used to. I'm,
yeah.
I'm 40 something, and I'm still skating, so. I just do the tricks that don't hurt my body as much.
I think all the shit I put my body through when I was younger makes me feel like I'm 40-something.
You know what helps if you're going to keep skating as you get older? Is because I was a big street skater, and that's like really hard on your body and stuff, and that's why I'm not doing stairs and stuff anymore, because it's like, you know, you're like ollie off of something, and then your body kind of takes a lot of impact when you hit the ground, you know, even though you kind of shock absorb it a bit, you're still taking a lot of impact. What helps as you get older is to actually skate transition, skate ramps, skate, you know, any transition in parks, because then when you're, like, you know, ollieing over, like, a lip or something or whatever, you're going, like, transition to transition, so it's, like, not so blunt, you know, it's not, like, such
an impact.
So it's a lot easier on your body.
It is a lot of impact.
Yeah, that stuff just looks painful. Like, when I watch it on YouTube, like, falling down stairs and shit. And why would you want to do that?
So, Gramps, it's fun.
Is it? When you make it on, it's fun, yeah. I could believe that. I could see I could get into it.
Yeah, but then again, I'm not going downstairs anymore.
Yeah.
there's a pretty rad skate park by my house, and it's got a full pipe and a couple bowls, and it's mostly transition. There's not a lot of street stuff on it.
Do you actually...
Oh, yeah, when they did finally... Go ahead, Jeff.
Well, it's just a side thing, but I was wondering, do you actually ski also, or do you not? Because, like, the one skateboarder guy I know here, he skis also.
Never lived in a ski resort my whole life, and I've never... I think the last time I went skiing, I was 5. The last time I went snowboarding, I was in high school, and I was 18. All my buddies took me up on all the big slopes, and I couldn't move for, like, 2 days. But it was adrenaline rush when it was happening, but... I don't do it.
Yeah, I've never been skiing, but I've been snowboarding since 1990.
Oh well, yeah, that's what he does actually, is snowboard.
Yeah.
So that's like a thing, all skateboard or snowboard also.
Maybe not all of them, but I mean, I feel like maybe it's also part of like growing up in California lifestyle type stuff, you know?
Yeah.
It's like surf, skate, snowboard, that kind of stuff. Because in the 60s, you know, you talk to the older surfers or something like that, for them it was surfing, skateboarding was new, and skiing, not snowboarding.
Yeah.
So, I might have been a skier if I was older, but snowboarding was more appealing. In 1990, I was 18, so.
Yeah. No, that makes sense. That's right. That's what I think, like, when I was getting out of high school and stuff, the snowboarding was getting all huge here and stuff, so that makes sense.
I remember you'd see it, I think I started seeing snowboarding around, like, 87, which would have been the beginning of my junior year in high school, and, like, Thrasher magazine and stuff like that, and I was like, what the hell's this? And then, like, 3 years later, I was just, like, couldn't get enough of it.
Man, a couple years ago, it's been longer than that, but do you remember when they came out like the skate decks that were made specifically for snow? They didn't have any trucks or any wheels.
Yeah.
It was just like a deck. Yeah. You ever try one of those?
No. I saw one guy. Is it this winter? Or maybe it was last winter. Yeah, it was 2 winters ago. Doing it, and it looked cool. I mean, I'm a skater, you know, so I was like, all right, well, he's skating, but there's just, like, I could see, like, doing, like, what am I trying to say? I can see you get, like, one of the, like, little snow parks or something like that, but, you know, part of when I'm going snowboarding, it feels so much more like surfing, and so I like to go way up top and, like, blast down the mountain as fast as I can. And I don't think you could do that on one of those little decks without, like, really hurting your, like, eating shit, you know?
Right.
They're just so tiny compared to a snowboard, you know? And so I don't know, you know? I can just see it being used in a little snow park thing. And then I saw these skis that somebody had that looked like big feet. Like, they were, like, cut out. Like, you know those, stickers, like, Hang 10? Like, with the feet prints?
Yeah.
They kind of look like that. And it was, like, cut out, like, a foot. And I think they're called Big Feet or something. I don't know.
And you can ski on them?
Yeah, and someone was skiing on them, and it didn't look like they really had any skis, kind of.
Yeah.
And they kept eating shit on them. So, I don't know. I guess it's something you gotta learn. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I just come so much from that surfing culture that I like the surf aspect of snowboarding.
Yeah. No, that actually makes sense. You know, surfing, skiing, or whatever, surfing, snowboarding, it's all kind of the same sort of movements and stuff or whatever, I guess.
If you skateboard and surf,
yeah.
Like, you're going to be snowboarding, like, right away, which is pretty cool.
Yeah.
Like, the learning curve wasn't that great.
It's just it's just the opposite foot steers, you know? Like...
Well, it's like... The way you steer, it's a lot like surfing. where you put your balance and stuff, I think.
Yeah. Nah, that's cool. Is that it? No more surfing talk?
I've never been surfing. The oceans I go to, the waves aren't big enough. So.
Where do you live again?
I live in Virginia, so like the ocean I go to is like Ocean City, Maryland, or like Myrtle Beach, South Carolina.
Okay. Yeah, I've gone like on tour out there. I've been to like Virginia Beach a bunch, but I can't remember.
Yeah.
Surf there or not?
That's about 4 hours from me, Virginia Beach.
Okay. Man, I always had a lot of fun in Virginia Beach every time I'm gone. But then again, it's always been in the context of being in a band, so I'm there for a day and gone. But
yeah,
never got to go surf out there. Someday, something's gonna pay off, and I'm gonna do like Scott McCloud did. What was it like three or four years ago? Do you know about this?
Where he
got an RV and he like set up like a working, like a mobile working station. like you got like a tiny, like I have this like little drafting board that folds up and it sits on top of a desk.
Yeah.
Well, so he could draw anywhere and so making his comics everywhere. And for a whole summer, he took his family around and he worked, you know, in comics at night or whatever, but. So, you know, he would do these speeches and appearances and about making comics and just for a whole summer with his wife and his daughter, and they just traveled. And then I think he did like vlogs, but I don't think he did it on YouTube.
Yeah.
I don't know. He documented every day.
That's kind of neat. Yeah, I should try to find those. How come all these old guys, like, I noticed that it's like, you know, like Dave Sim, he does like video stuff, and like it's not on YouTube. It's like on his own site somewhere or something.
Yeah, it's
come in, just get on YouTube.
There's something weird that I think there's a disconnect with people like them, who are like just a little bit older than us. They're like, it's like they think that they don't own the content or something, or
I don't know.
You know, that's what I'm guessing because I feel like I've heard that before.
Yeah.
I don't want to put that in public because then anyone could see it. It's like, yeah, that's the point.
Yeah.
You want people to see it. Because I know, like, Dave Sim, he had, like, a paid site for a while.
Oh, did he? Yeah.
It was, like, yeah, it was called, like, Cerberus TV.
Yeah. Well, when I was, yeah, because I had lost track of that, you know, I guess because, you know, not on YouTube, but it's like, when I was there, it wasn't paid, but I remember it was like the content would like, it was just like one big stream.
Uh-huh.
So like you had the, you just jumped on and then like the show was like, the new show was like in there somewhere if you put one in one up. So you just like start watching and then eventually it would either come up or it wouldn't. It was just crazy. It was like totally unhandy the way he was doing it.
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah. I didn't know he had a pay site also. That's pretty interesting.
Yeah, I don't know if he still has one, but...
It's pretty wild.
I think it was called Cerberus TV, if it's still out there.
Yeah. But that's that Scott McCloud thing, it's like... You know, I've always kind of thought that same thing, that would be fun, but I don't know if the reality would be as fun as I think of it in my head, because, I mean, God, I spend so much time in here drawing, I don't know if, like, if we went on vacation, I think my wife would just be mad at me because I don't, you know, we'd like drive somewhere and then they'd go do stuff. I don't know. She'd go for that.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking about that. I mean, Scott McCloud's style is super simple.
Yeah.
And he's been doing it for years, so got to think in a way that's probably comes fast, comes quick for him, you know? But at the same time, you know, when I'm working, it's for hours and hours and hours, which wouldn't kind of let me go on a road trip working tour, you know?
Yeah.
So if that's the case, I think you have to kind of say, like, you know what I mean? He was getting money because he was, you know, speaking in different towns every day, so he was getting paid for that. So he wasn't feeling like a total vagabond, you know?
Yeah.
But he kept saying, you know, yeah, you know, I'm still working. I'm still working on my comic. It would have to be like this 100 Days Making Comics, or I'd do like 30 minutes a day or something.
You know, yeah.
You'd be driving or, you know, can't ink in an RV when it's moving.
Right. Yeah, that would be tough to ink. I probably could drive. I've actually sketched in like long road trips. Or I mean, I probably could draw, you know. But I was gonna say though, there was this, I remember reading about this one artist, Bev Doolittle. I don't know if you know who she is. She's like, has like gallery stuff. I mean, she's real famous for painting like those horses, like the paint horses that mix in with the rocks and stuff.
Oh,
you know?
Yeah, my father-in-law loved that.
Right. Got real popular for a while. But like she, like, you know, like in the front of like her book, it kind of like talks about like how she got famous and, you know, big and everything. And she would do the outdoor shows, and they would just like do that every summer. They'd get in their RV and like hit all these outdoor shows everywhere. And she would like, you know, paint. And then they would like just go from show to show, and then like just like live out of this RV. And I always thought that's kind of like a cool thing. But I don't know. I don't like I said, I don't know if I get much work done.
Yeah.
You just hit all the Comic Cons and just go show to show.
I think it would be awesome if you, you know, if you could afford to I don't know, for 9 months just work your ass off.
Yeah.
You know, get a lot of stuff and then just like travel and do shows and, you know.
Yeah.
Just know that, like, you know, I might do one or two pieces while I'm on the road because it's going to take that long.
Yeah. Well, if you had, like, some way to make, you know, like if the painting sold for more or something and you made more money, you didn't have to paint as much.
Yeah.
You know, totally, yeah. Had an awesome Patreon account or something, I don't know. Could totally do that.
So anyway, I'm going to go ahead and wrap the show up. I got to take the dog outside and everything. She's like making noises out there. So, but thanks for everybody watching. Do you guys want to say your websites, Kevin?
Sure, kevincross.net.
Cool. And Brody?
BrodyWilliams.com and on Facebook, Brody Williams.
Yep, and let's see, Scott was on the show, he's circworks.com. Jay was on the show, he's airheadscustom.com with a Z. And I think that was everybody. And I'm Jeff Lafferty, jefflafferty.net. I also have a Patreon, if you guys want to support the show, head on over there. Thanks a lot, and we'll see you tomorrow.